Okay. First of all, I want to welcome the new viewers, the new subscribers to these videos. I noticed there's quite a few new subscribers. That's great. And I also want to also welcome the old timers that have been here quite some time and the ones that have been here for a while. I want to welcome everyone to this video and all the videos. And I have something for you. I have something for the new subscribers. I have something for the old subscribers and the ones in between. I have something for everybody. I have a gold mine, actually, a gold mine today. So, with that in mind, this is great good news I have to impart. Very historic, because everyone in the world has access to it. We're not talking about some, some shrouded monastery in the Tibetan Himalayas. We're not talking about some secret ashram in India that's really far to find, and we're not talking about some Christian monastery where the Christian mystics are practicing, and in some dark, deep forest. We're not talking about that. We're talking about this is available to everyone in the world. Free of charge, right here, right now, like this. This is very historic, this information. This is high spiritual literacy that we are going to be talking today. Extremely high spiritual literacy, extremely great information. Now, if it looks like I'm dressed up for an expedition to a Tibetan monastery, it's because it's very cold here. Let me set the scene. I am sitting here in the South Bay area of California, San Francisco Bay Area, California. It's about 11:15 in the morning, something like that. 11:20, let's say. It's very overcast, heavy cloudiness. It rained last night. It's cold, very cold. It's chilly. There's a breeze that is one more. Okay, there's a breeze that is breezing through that really is cold. And we're outside here on this morning of January 31st, 2016. January 31st, 2016. And we have a gold mine of spiritual literacy to impart here. So I'm fired up. I've been fired up all morning. Got up, had tremendous breakthrough this morning. Got up and did all my stretching and flexibility exercises and got on the scale, great weight, 181.7. I feel limber, I feel fit, I feel very, very great. And I thought maybe I can play golf today. I haven't played golf in a long time. Well, it's terrible conditions. I said, no, have to wait for better conditions, okay? But this means that I can just give full concentration on this. Now, when we impart great good news, you have to be patient. We have to be patient. We don't want to rush it. We have to take a little bit of time, kind of like my breakfast this morning, which was a tart red cherry juice, a banana, and chocolate protein powder in a smoothie. It wasn't so good tasty because I was out of normal protein drinks. I had to go to the tart red cherry juice. But I can say this, since I have been eating properly in terms of exercise, I haven't had any sore muscles, any achy muscles, nothing. It's amazing. Absolutely astonishing. And tart red cherry juice is part of that regimen, actually. But I just wouldn't recommend it too much with chocolate protein powder and banana. I think it tastes better cold, chilled by itself, actually. But hey, it's all good. That's my breakfast. And just a little bit of that. What is it? There's something that is. One moment. Something that is in getting in my eye there. I don't know what it is, but hopefully it's gone. So I'm fired up. I had this great insight this morning, and I just said, "Hey, Jesus, get fired up! Get fired up! Yes!" I went to bed last night saying, "Jesus, Jesus, 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 Jesus." Now, let me say this before we go any further. There are five teachers that we have to thank for this real high spiritual literacy that we're getting and we're going to get in this video, this tremendous sharing. First and foremost, we have the grace of God that we call the Holy Spirit. You can call it what you want. That's numero uno, number one. The rest of them in no particular order, but we'll just say Jesus Christ. We will say Sri Sri Anandamayi, we will say Raman Maharshi, and we will say Longchenpa. So those five great teachers who know the truth, are responsible for helping this sharing take place. Okay, they're the ones that have been supporting this. They're the ones who have been pushing this. They're the ones. Now there may be others behind the scenes, but those are the faces that I'm aware of. Those, and they are doing a great job. And I told them, get fired up, Jesus, get fired up, Sri Sri Anandamayi, get fired up, be fired up. This is fantastic, the breakthrough. Ramana Maharshi, get fired up. Yes, be fired up, Ramana. This is fantastic what you've done. Longchenpa, be fired up, be on fire, Push this through, This is fantastic. Yes. This is fantastic breakthrough we've had this morning. Epic, historic. So, I was really fired up this morning. Still am a little bit, but we got to drive through the city streets before we get to the freeway here. So, you don't want to be going too fast through the city streets. So, we let it unfold here. We just ease into it. These teachers have done a great job. They have really done a fabulous job. So, they should be fired up. I hope they are. Because I'm really fired up for them. Because what their work is bearing fruit. We have this orchid that we've had for years and years. And it, every year it flowers again. Beautiful orchid flowers. It's amazing. Well, we just saw some last night. Four, and there's a small fifth one coming. It's like, wow. That's fantastic. It did it again. It's bearing flowers. It's bearing fragrance. It's bearing beauty. And so this teaching that these great teachers have been trying to get through to us, it's getting through. It's getting through here. It's getting through to me. That means it can get through to anyone. I mean, I'm hard-headed and stubborn and slow, and, you know, if it can get through to me, it can get through to anyone. So, we'll just ease along here into this wonderful, wonderful, I don't know what I'm going to say or how I'm going to say it, but the attitude is very important. And I am absolutely fired up. I'm happy. I'm fired up for myself, for the teachers, and for everyone in the world, is that it's very good news. We have very good news for all of us. The gospel means good news. The gospel, the good news. Jesus came to bring the gospel of salvation. And indeed, he is still bringing the gospel of salvation, and he knows what he's talking about. This is great news. These teachers know what they're talking about. And they have something to impart to us, and we're very foggy and very confused. Like I have like a confusion hangover. You know, I see the truth, but this confusion hangover is still, I'm kind of fuzzy about it. You know, and this is how it goes. Now, when I had this breakthrough, I said, I have to bandage my success now. So what is it? Well, this is the new normal. Full stop in the wow. And this has to become my new normal. So that is what I'm doing today. I'm just living with this breakthrough. And just letting it sink in. It says, okay, now for the rest, for forever, I have this now perspective now. I'm aware of this perspective. It's forms part of my functioning identity. So the same when you hear the good news, you have to manage your success. All of us do. It's important. This is now the new normal. This is not something I throw away. No, this is something now that's integral to my understanding and perspective. Absolutely integral. This is this perspective we have. And I'm still in the wow, actually, of this. So it's not, It's going to take a little while for this to emerge, and we'll see what we can do. But I want to convey to everyone that there's tremendous hope for us. Tremendous hope for us. When you see the perspective that I got this morning, you are going to be full of hope. Real hope. Wow. My suffering days are coming to an end. You will see it. And at that point, you just sort of go into this, wow, wow. So this is first and foremost, prepare for success. Be prepared for success is the most key ingredient of the spiritual path. That's the key ingredient for success. This success will not come to us until we prepare for it. It's not like it comes to us first and then we prepare. We prepare first, and then when we're able to handle this perspective, then it comes to us. So I worked out yesterday, Saturday. Knocking out the jump rope, and oh boy, that was tough. And stretching, did a lot of workout. And this morning I feel great. Very limber. Very athletic and limber today. But this wind is just, it is really, this is like one of the worst weather days we've had in the last 5 years. Maybe the worst. It's terrible. It's Arctic-like. I mean, it's just, so just going to stay at home here and tape, work. I was working with pictures of Jesus and with Course in Miracles lessons on each one of them. I was uploading pictures of Ram Maharshi Longchenpa the day before, uploading pictures of Jesus last night. I'm working all this on Flickr to have all these pictures available to us. But that pales in comparison. It's a positive influence. It's encouraging influence. But it pales in comparison to this perspective that dawned on me this morning. And I'm just waiting for how to ease into that. Well, you're not going to force it. Not going to force it. Don't force things. Stretch. Be patient. Prepare to succeed. Are you ready to hear the gospel, the good news? How spiritual literate are you? Well, we can increase our spiritual literacy today, and we will. We will. And the fact is, this perspective is absolutely in line with all the videos I've done. It is very much in line. We are on the right track. This is another great thing to say. We are on the right track here. Big time. Validating. This validated everything I've done in my life. It validated it. It says, look at this. Oh my gosh. Extreme validation. Now, we don't jump the gun. When we get a great perspective, we don't jump the gun. We don't try to then project, okay, what am I going to do? When am I going to be enlightened? When am I going to this? No, we got the full stop in the wow. When we get a great breakthrough perspective like this, wow. Okay, so I'm not going to say, what am I going to do? How successful am I going to be? I can say in hindsight, this validates. In hindsight, it validates for sure. I'm not going to measure anything, measure the validation. So managing our success is the number one priority. Without that, we'll never get anywhere. We never get anywhere. But when we do manage our success, these tremendous breakthroughs happen. And I'd say this morning, it was a tremendous breakthrough. Now, I can summarize it. Give you a little taste. I was saying, okay, I was just sort of talking about this, and then it suddenly hit me, wow, this is so important. And I forgot it. I blanked out for a while. I said, uh-oh. I just stayed patient, and then it came back, what I had said. And that is, we don't have to help God win any contest at all. We don't have to help God win any contest because there is no contest. God is not, reality is not being contested. Now, this is just a little clue as to what the perspective really is. But in seeing this, I said, oh my gosh, we don't have to help God win any contest, so we don't have to be in any contest ourselves, do we? And you see that when that starts dawning, when I seeing that, oh my gosh. And I saw the relevancy of it all. Now, the wow comes when we have an insight where we see the relevancy of it, and it's so profound that it's immeasurably profound. And at that point, we don't struggle to try to measure it or assess it. We just go, wow, okay? This is so important. Just go, wow. You will have these insights too. We all will at some point when we're prepared to. So we don't try to assess it or measure it. We already saw that it's just all-encompassing, you might say. And I'm still feeling the wow. When I look at this, it's just wow. We don't have to help God out at all. We don't have to help God win. And then I realize, isn't that what we're trying to do? What so many are trying to do? We're trying to help you, God. We're trying to help you defeat the darkness, defeat evil, get all this stuff. There is no contest. The contest is completely made up by Spirit, 100%. In the arrogant desire to be greater than God, Spirit imagined that God was in a contest. That reality was being contested. And this gave Spirit the notion that God is not omnipotently perfect prime creator, that therefore Spirit could pretend that it could be greater than God, or it's greater than God, because God is in this contest. And Spirit says, well, if God wins the contest, then I don't know what happens, but the idea that God is being contested gives Spirit this presumptive greaterness than God. So it's spirit that is imagining this contest between light and dark, between good and evil, between suffering and pleasure and pain, between as if God was actually being contested by this pain and suffering and misery and darkness and evil and all this kind of stuff, right? But it's completely being made up like a dream by Spirit. Now, when Spirit says, hey, God, I'm helping you win this contest, what is Spirit doing except affirming that there is a contest? Think of God as pure spaciousness, and then ask yourself, is anything that arises in pure spaciousness, is that contesting pure spaciousness? Can pure spaciousness be contested? Now, I have to thank Longchenpa for introducing, giving me the experience of pure spaciousness, or helping induce it, you might say, and helping me focus on what he's getting at. And this has been extremely helpful. As he says that everything that arises, it arises as pure spaciousness. Everything that is sustained as pure spaciousness, and everything that dissipates is dissipated as pure spaciousness. Everything is alpha pure spaciousness, intrinsically, without any effort whatsoever. It's all spontaneously this way. Everything is spontaneously, intrinsically, inherently, spontaneously pure spaciousness, ornamenting pure spaciousness, really. As he said, all appearances are just decorations of their own intrinsic spaciousness. So, spaciousness is not being blocked or obscured or contested in any way, pure spaciousness, in any way. And this is God. The ground of all being is God. There's nothing contesting that at all. Now, Jesus has helped us out so much in pointing out that there's this intermediate step between dualistic perception and knowing. And what he is, which is called vision, spiritual vision. What Jesus tells us is that knowing, we can know, but it's not really possible to remain in this realm, a dualistic realm, when we just know. We cannot remain here. He said I believe what he says. But he says, vision we can. We can actually function with vision, non-dual vision. He called it vision of Christ, vision of oneness, vision of sameness. Longchamp calls it vision of sameness. They're all talking about the same vision, of non-dual vision, of what? Spaciousness, pure spaciousness, and seeing that it's uncontested. Seeing that it's uncontested. So as we look out in this world, with all form and activity, everything that arises, we're able to see that pure spaciousness is not being contested at all by anything that's arising. And we just abide in this vision, this seeing, this vision. Sensory perception gives the appearance that everything that's arising is somehow blocking pure spaciousness, is an absence of pure spaciousness, an absence. It's occupying some area which is not pure spaciousness. But this is not true. This is called dualism, dualistic perception, thinking there's spaciousness and then objects in spaciousness. But spiritual vision, the vision of sameness, realizes that everything is the same in that it's all pure spaciousness. It's not a blocking or obscuring or displacing pure spaciousness or corrupting or doing anything to it at all. And we can literally see the whole world, the universe, in this way. We can see it this way. This is called, Jesus says, vision, spiritual vision. Vision. He says, this is our goal. This is our goal. This is our goal that he has for us. Now, as far as knowing, he says that ultimately takes place when God realizes, sees, knows. God knows that we're truly ready for it after we've already gotten very accustomed to spiritual vision, very accustomed to it, where it's just, this is now our identity. This is our realization. We're extremely accepting and it's completely normal for us. But that's on down the road. This is not a goal that we set for ourselves at all. Knowing is not a goal. So take that off the board. It's vision that we can reach here. It is absolutely vision. I've had glimpses of it. And I've been working towards it very, very intensely. And you just say, oh, my gosh. Yeah, nothing is obscuring pure spaciousness. Nothing is displacing it. Nothing is blocking awareness of it. The awareness is seamless. And everything is the same in that way. Everything is exactly the same. It's just pure spaciousness. It's not in its own way at all. Nothing's in its own way. Everything is the same. The vision of sameness, the great sameness. Both Jesus and Longchamp emphasize it. They all do. The teachers, the great five teachers we have here. Now, how do we do this? We realize one moment here, let's just sink in. There's no real contest with God at all. We have to accept that. We're the ones putting on this contest. And so what we are engaged in this ferocious conflict, aren't we? Contest of trying to survive life and death, you might call it, right? But we're staging this contest entirely in our imagination. And we claim that, we say, God, we're just trying to help you. We got this, there's this terrible evil that's trying to attack you and bring you down. We're just trying to help you, you know, fight it off. This is again how we delude ourselves that's a saying there is a contest. God is being contested. when we see the vision of sameness, we see there's no contest at all. Nothing is happening in terms of a contest. There's all this beauty arising, ornamentation of spaciousness arising, but there's no contest at all. That's all. Vision of no contest, you might say. And of course, when we accept there's no contest, we don't need to struggle against anything. There's nothing we need to do. We don't need to help God. God is not in need of any help. There isn't any contest. But it also means we don't need to set up an imaginary contestant for ourselves to struggle against. And I say we can ascend into the retirement realm. In Buddhism, you say the pure realms, Jesus, the kingdom of heaven, the death-free realm. Non-maya-masa, the death-free realms. We can ascend to those realms and dwell there, where there's no contestment taking place, no contest taking place. Just this beautiful, glorious ornamentation of spaciousness, and we enjoy it. It means we don't need to be sick. We don't need to age. We don't need to die. We don't need to struggle. We don't need to be set by vulnerability in these troubles. All of this stuff is just our own imagination so that we can believe a contest is taking place, that contestment is taking place. And of course, the body is how we make it seem like there's a contest going on, because the body is struggling for each breath. You know, it has to keep eating and try to survive. It seems like there's a contest taking place, that the life of the body is being contested by all these, you know, difficulties. We drive, everything we do is like, I got to keep the body safe. The body's so vulnerable. The hero of the contest is the body, so to speak. Now, we don't have to get rid of this hero. We could just put this hero in retirement mode. No contest, it's not being contested anymore. You hear these stories like of these teachers that are internally youthful and they show up in the world occasionally, like Babaji in India lore. This is what they do. I mean, you see these teachers like Sri Sri Nandamayi, her body seemed to age. She said, well, because that's what you want, so I don't care how my body looks. If you want it to age, I'll let it age. But really, she was eternally youthful. There was no contestment, nothing challenging at all, nothing challenging the reality of pure spaciousness at all. And look at Jesus, rose from the dead. He said, you want to see me die? You think you have power over me? Okay, I'll show you. You know, go ahead if that's what you want, but I'll raise my body up. And there's no contest. My body is not being contested at all. Nothing's being contested. Reality is not being contested. Only reality is real. There is no other. There is nothing else. There's no contest at all taking place, actually. So, these are just words, but I really saw it and put it all in context. And this is what's so powerful. I recognize the profundity of it. I said, oh, wow, that's really the key. It's really the key, isn't it? It's very key. That this whole contest is just a way that we try to feel superior to God. That's it. And then we say, hey, God, no, we're not trying to feel superior. We're just trying to help you out. You're being attacked. But then, in order to try to convince God that God's being attacked, in order we can play this game, we have to feel we're being attacked. How can we say we're helping God if we're not struggling with some attacker? Right? How will we see that this is all made up? We don't have to keep imagining some attacker that we're struggling with. We don't need to imagine death or sickness or any of that. We don't need to struggle with anything. We don't need to help God. We don't need to say, hey, God, we're helping you by trying to fight off death. And, you know, no, we don't need death at all. We don't need an adversary. We don't need any adversarial situation or feeling whatsoever. And this is the great peace, no conflict, no more struggle. No more conflict, no more struggle, no more conflict, no more contestment of our peace of mind, of our total vision of totality, vision of sameness. Nothing's challenging it at all. The clear light of spaciousness is not challenged by light, by white light or dark light or any appearances. Those are just appearances. And again, ornamentations of their own intrinsic spaciousness, their own intrinsic clear lightness. How can anything challenge clear light, pure spaciousness? So again, these are just words, but it lends a certain spiritual literacy to what we're doing here, as we're getting into this area now, which is fruitful. We're getting into the fruitful area, where the fruit is ready to pick. It's like the test the sugar content of the fruit, say, oh my gosh, it's ready to pick. The fruit's ready to pick. It's right there, it's easy. So this whole dream is a scam, trying to scam God, saying that there's a contest taking place. There's no contest taking place. We're making it all up. And the light, trying to defeat the darkness, that light is also just decoration of its own intrinsic space, of its own intrinsic spaciousness, just as the darkness is also just decoration of its own intrinsic spaciousness. And they're exactly the same. In that way, there's no contest at all taking place between the two. Nothing isn't being contested. It's all just pure spaciousness. It's all God. It's just all God. There's nothing other than God. There's no contest, nothing to contest. There's no contestment taking place. So this is the vision that we can see this. We can literally see this. This is what they all tell us. Okay. All the great teachers, they tell us, we can see this, we can be aware of this. I'm not saying we can know it at this point. We're not trying to know it. This is very important. We are not trying to know this at all. We are seeing it. It's still perception. It's still perception. Our continuity fear doesn't really allow us to know it. We wouldn't remain here for very long at all if we were knowing of this, because knowing is just pure knowing. Of the totality, that's all it is. And there's no reference at all. There's no reference at all for knowing, except the totality. So we still want to have some reference here that there is no contest, for instance, okay, right? Because we're so used to this dream that we don't want to have no reference of this dream whatsoever, instantly. That's too much continuity fear for us. But we can perceptually see the absolute sameness, okay, of the dream, the absolute sameness of everything arising. I wore as many layers as I could here, but it's still cold. The chill is cutting through everything here. Oh, well. Now, so this introduces this. It's just a step. We're just taking a step. We don't go too fast. We're just hearing it. We're just hearing this. Wow. We're saying, okay, there's something here. And we have faith in those who are doing the sharing that there's something really worth sharing. I have to have faith in that. I had faith in my teachers, for sure. I stuck with them. I say, I know there's something profound that you have to share, and it's just my own confusion and continuity fear that is getting in the way. So I just have to keep working at it. That's what they say. You just have to keep working at it. There isn't any other way. And so this is what we have to do. Now I had an experience even during waking time of being aware of this pure spaciousness. And it was just like, oh wow, Now I can see what they're talking about. I know, now I can see what they're talking about, these teachers said. That's what I said. Oh, now I can see what they're talking about. So that's it. It was that simple. Oh, so that's it. So from that point, I've had to then simplify all my spiritual understanding, all aiming just for this vision, just for this seeing. That's it. That's all we need. Because this is seeing, there is no contest taking place. And this is what is necessary, crucial for us, because we have to recognize we have been engaged in this contest. We are the ones staging this contest and claiming that God is being contested. God's not being contested. But we, in staging this contest, certainly feel there's a contest taking place, don't we? And since we're one with God, we feel that we're being contested. And then we think we have to fight it off. And then we think we can be the hero and protect God and save the world, save reality from destruction. This is just, I guess, our imagination making all this up. And yet, the sensory perception seems to indicate all this is happening. All this contestment is happening. But really, it's not. There's nothing real being contested. There's just illusions contesting other illusions. Illusions of crystallization seeming to affect other illusions of crystallization. But there's no crystallization of spaciousness taking place at all. These things are not crystallizations of pure spaciousness. That's our misperception, our misinterpretation. Again, this helps advance our spiritual literacy, and it works. I mean, how did I get to this, seeing this, or recognizing it, and saying, wow, or at least having this dawning of awareness, saying, this is it? Through continually trying greater spiritual literacy, focusing on this, and narrowing it down, and realizing this is it. This is actually it. So we bestow retirement upon the hero of the dream, the body-mind, the psyche, the personality, the person, all of this complex that we believe is what we are. We now say, it's uncontested. There's no contestment. It doesn't have to struggle anymore. It can just abide in peace and bliss and enjoyment. We don't need to put it in a realm where it's contested, where it's threatened. We don't need a realm that threatens. This is all, again, this whole world is a realm that gives the illusion of threat. We don't need to dwell in such a realm. Now that we see there's no contest, we just made it up, there isn't any contest, reality is not being contested at all, then we certainly don't need a hero that is struggling in a contest, do we? But we don't want to jettison what our creativity has been working with and identifying with for so long. So we just ascend. We just have this hero of the dream dwell in a non-threatening realm, reduced intensity realm, where the threat is vastly reduced in intensity. Any plausibility, you just say, I just don't see it, you know. It's I guess the potential might be, we could reactivate it if necessary. It's not demanding that it not be reactivated, this our imagination, but I'm not seeing any threat at all. So the hero of the dream, the psyche complex, the belief system, is now, can still be present, but it's not involved in any struggle or contest. It's not being contested by anything. Now death is a way of trying to show God, look, God, there really is this terrible attack against life going on. And we made it all up. We made this up. It's just dream body being affected by dream death in a dream contest to try and so we can believe that God is under threat, is being contested, that perfection, that invulnerability is under threat. So it's this dream of threat, of contestment. So again, we don't have to help God win this contest. We say, we think that we're warriors for God, helping God win a contest. This is the essential delusion that we've been laboring under, right? This is called the good. And Jesus says, don't call me good. He knew what they were trying to do. They're trying to make him the savior. You're a warrior king that's come to, you know, help us defeat the evil in the world. And Jesus said, no, that's not why I'm here. I'm here to help you see you got it all wrong. So the idea of a savior coming in and being like a great king, warrior, who will lead the tribe into battle and defeat the enemies and conquer and put them on the throne forever, this type of savior, that's delusion. When Jesus came, some accepted him, some rejected him, some said, oh, you're not the Messiah. We're looking for a warrior king that's going to unite the kingdoms and drive out all, you know, the enemies, defeat the Romans, defeat everybody. And Jesus said, no, you got it all wrong. And you know, some said, hey, I believe that he's telling us the truth here, and we need to reassess this whole situation. So my response to seeing this was just yes. Be fired up, teachers. You should be fired up. The teachers should just be dancing with jubilation to that this recognition is really being seen more and more and more here. Like, I really get it. I really see it. Yes, that's it. Yes. So I imagine they're quite jubilant. Absolutely. Have to be. So we can't force anything. And I'm not going to try and predict anything. I just keep going, keep managing the success. But I can say, seeing in this way, is very profound. Because see, this is the end of our suffering. When we can accept this perspective, this is the end of all our suffering, entirely. Finished. It's the end of death. It's the end of all of that. We should not, we don't, that'll just come, be there. We don't want to force anything in particular, specifically. It's just the end of all struggle, all contestment, period. So we will feel uncontested. This beautiful feeling of uncontestment is ours, as these teachers have promised us. So one of the great aspects of this is it validates these teachers. Validates them. That's why I'm saying what a great day this is. They're getting the validation they deserve. A feeling of sameness, the feeling of uncontestment, no contestment at all, is taking place at all. Never has, and never will. This world here is, of course, a very clever illusion that we have constructed to give the impression of contestment. You see the ants dying, little insects are dying, and Jesus said it's all an illusion to give the impression there's a contest, that God is under attack, that life is under attack, that really there's nothing arising or being attacked and dying at all. It's just pure spaciousness, ornamentations of pure spaciousness that never stray one iota from their intrinsic spaciousness, from their spontaneity of being, pure spaciousness. And it's just all a dance of light, actually. It's just all a dance of appearance. There's no definition of life at all, really, that has any meaning. Because all is life, intrinsically, spontaneously so. It never can never stray from that at all. Can never stray from the ground of being pure spaciousness. Life is really, as Longchamp said, just a mere label, devoid of any real meaning at all. There's nothing's being contested. But again, we don't need to struggle to try and force understanding or application to it. What's important is to manage the wow of it. And just get comfortable with the wow of it. The elation of it. You know, seeing this, I was elated. Now, we can take this whole issue of contestment and push it into the future and say, well, if we want to experience this, it'll be in a future life. If we want to reactivate this belief, we can do it in a future life. But for this life, it's finished. No more. So this gives us that essential wiggle room that continuity fear demands. Okay, continuity fear demands an option. It's afraid of knowing. Continuity fear really is the fear of knowing. Okay, so we have to acknowledge this. We do have a very much dread of knowing. And so we keep this wiggle room that, hey, I can reactivate this belief in contestment if I want to down the road. But I'm committed. We can commit to this life, no more. No more belief in that. I would say this is the apex approach of pragmatism, which acknowledges our continuity fear, which we really have. We really have a very much a dread of knowing. We don't have to know right now. We can keep the option alive as far as at some point if we want to reactivate the belief in contest, we can do so. So we keep the hero of the dream viable in some way, right? In a beautiful Pure Land realm. And that's not a problem. The sun's coming out, if you can call it that. It's very chilly here. Okay. Justin. Now, just the success, seeing the success, oh, I succeeded, I really succeeded in taking a look at this, at the core of it all. This produces a huge wow, because if I can do it once, I can do it again and again, and it wasn't difficult. So, of course, this is going to produce a huge wow. That means I'm certainly one of the fortunate ones, to say the least. Anyone who sees this is certainly, they recognize their great good fortune. It's a gold mine. It's a gold mine. It's like coming across this vast gold mine. Oh, wow. Gold is a symbol of this no contestment, no contest. It's a symbol of it, right? Because it doesn't corrupt, it doesn't rust. It doesn't really mix with anything else in terms of you can always extract it from it. It doesn't lose its properties. It's a symbol of the smoothness, of pure spaciousness, of non-contestment. So it's like coming across this huge gold mine, huge pile of gold. I mean, it's just, you struck it rich. You struck it rich. This is what I felt like, that I've struck it rich, so rich. And so I have to accommodate this feeling now and make it the new normal, that I'm just, you know, one of the extraordinary fortunate ones who has struck it infinitely rich. So this recognition goes along with it. It goes along. So this, you know, this has to be accommodated, and it produces a big wow. So in the training that I'm giving, it's managing our success comes first. The insights come second, actually. Because when the insights arise, that you will recognize, oh my gosh, I'm going to be fabulously successful. And this is a very powerful feeling. Quite shocking. We're so used to seeing ourselves as these puny little bodies struggling against the inevitable death and aging and sickness and difficulties, and that we're just up against some inexorable force and we're doing our best. We're so used to seeing ourselves as contested that to recognize that we can experience ourselves as uncontested comes as quite a shock. But not too much. I mean, I'm fine. Because every day I work to establish a new normal. This is the whole key to the spiritual path. Every day we must work to establish a new normal. And so when we get to this recognition, this great recognition, it's just like, okay, well, I mean, this is established, a new normal, just like I do every day. And it's not too far from what I had yesterday. It's not. It's quite close, but it is farther, clearer. I had a clearer picture of it all. Okay, so this is the new normal, and just let that sink in. So if we, which is a little what I've done my whole life, every single day of my life, I have worked to establish a new normal. Every day, without missing any day. Now, we're all struggling to do that somehow, but the more conscious we are of it, the better. But we really consciously work at it. So every day I tried to, no matter what, I tried to get a better perspective. I said, I want to see this in a different way. How can I see this in a different way? And now I'm seeing this in really a different way. Wow. The root of it all. But again, that's not a big jump from where I was yesterday at all. It's just a nice little step. But the riches that I see, the imminency of the imminent riches, the imminency of the imminent riches, the riches are right there. I say, oh gosh, now I can see how easy it is. Wow, I can be free of suffering. Holy cow. So it brings a punch to it, really a very nice punch of elation, punch of elation. Now we don't run out and try to confuse the issue by sex, drugs, and rock and roll, right? By any complex of trying to confuse why am I elated, No, we just say that I'm elated because of seeing this, the recognition, the spiritual recognition. So we stay calm. This is why there's discipline on the spiritual path, is you don't try to conflate or confuse what you feel with something else, like it's coming from something else, some other source. No, we know exactly where it's coming from. There's nothing that kids love more than shooting basketball hoops, it seems like. This is what I've noticed. At some age, they get a hoop, basketball hoop, and boy, I was the same way. I just would shoot all day. Contest. We want to win a contest. I'm here. I'm going to help God win a contest. I'm going to help my team win a contest. That kind of thing. Wow. There's nothing we need to do at all. God does not require us to help God win anything, win a contest. No. The grace of God certainly helps us recognize this fact that there's nothing I need to do. So we can encourage others, but not through trying to do something to help God win a contest. but by abiding in the peaceful, blissful, non-contested state. The uncontested state. The uncontestable state is a better way to put it. The uncontestable state. We're seeing that which is uncontestable, which is everything, which is all. That's all there is. So this seeing, this vision, is our goal. I believe it's reachable. I believe this vision is reachable, and I believe ascension is reachable. Both of those. Ascension can, we can choose ascension if this world becomes too nasty, overly contested, which could really make it difficult to witness here, or it could even pull us back down into the belief in contestment. The confusion may become so severe here. The ego is trying to maximize trouble and confusion here, maximize the idea of contestment taking place, that ascension to another realm may be called for. The Christians certainly believe that will happen, and they may be right. But we can have this vision even here, even in this world. Even if we stay here, we can have the vision of sameness, absolutely, of uncontestability. The vision of uncontestability, the alpha pure guru vision of uncontestability. We can have this right here. In fact, we can have it anywhere, because it's true everywhere. There's nowhere we need to go to see this vision. It's everywhere. The sameness is same everywhere. It's uncontestability. Pure spaciousness is uncontestable. And we can see that anywhere we are. Anywhere and everywhere. So it's here now, it's here now, it's here now. And it's not dependent on time to get rid of any contestment or to win a contest. There's no contest to win. So what do we need time for? We can see this right here, this vision right here, right now. Right here, right now. Now, this is the fabled vision of oneness, vision of sameness, and we might think, wow, I haven't won anything. I don't deserve that. What do you mean? There isn't any contest to win, so how can we not deserve it? You mean that God doesn't deserve to be seen as God? That the uncontestability of God doesn't deserve to be seen that way? That's what we're saying. That's arrogant. To say that we don't deserve this is arrogant, because then we're holding on to the belief that God can be contested. That's what arrogance is. So we need to drop our arrogance. And see the uncontestability of God. So when I saw this morning, I knew this is very much in alignment with what these teachers are saying. Very much in alignment. So that's what really was a very exciting, much elation. It's like, wow, this is good news for us. I'm just braving the elements here to get this through. It's I don't know what I'll do the rest of the day. It's doesn't matter. We are getting this done right now. Doesn't matter. Now, could go play golf, and I don't even contest golf or pay much attention to keeping score or whatever. I can keep score a little, you know, I can do it, but you know, whatever, it's just, it's fun, it's enjoyable, it's aesthetics, it's beauty, it's enjoying the beauty, it's enjoying a soaring drive, and just watching it go, 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 hang in the air, and then bounce, bounce, roll, roll, roll. So the hero still feels like it's a hero, a little bit. It's out there on the course being heroic, but it's tongue-in-cheek kind of thing, and it's not really serious, and it's easy to laugh, and... It helps sort of reduce the overall notion of contestment. I don't really like to play competitive golf and trying to beat somebody else. I don't like that. I like to go out with just myself because there's no feeling like you're contesting with anybody. I don't want any contestment. And some people also, they don't feel that way either. And so when you go out with them, they're just having fun. You hit a bad shot, it's funny. You laugh. You say, "Oh, well, see if I can do it the next one." Oh, that's fun. Miss the putt or make the putt. Say, okay. Great. On to the next hole. Oh, that's a beautiful place. Look at this. Oh, it's lovely. And hitting a shot down there. It's like, oh, look at that beautiful shot. It's rolling somewhere really beautiful. That's the cool thing. You hit the ball, you don't know where it's going to go, right? You don't know where you're going to end up, but you know it's going to be somewhere beautiful on a really beautiful course. It's like all options are good. It really is. Feel like some courses are so beautiful that all options are good. Even when you hit one in the water, you get to go over right near the water and drop a ball there, and the water's so beautiful. You just say, "Oh, this is wonderful. I can't lose here. I cannot lose." So it's this feeling of I cannot lose in the ascension realms. I can't lose. I just can't lose here. No matter what I do, it's just all beautiful. It's all wonderful. It's all uncontested beauty. Everything is just uncontestable in terms of its beauty and spacious, pure spaciousness. We see that. Its ornamentation seems so beautiful to us. So I just keep working, getting in shape. But not to win a contest, you see, but just to enjoy. So I feel I can get out there and enjoy as much as possible. We'll see what happens. I don't know what's going to happen with my life. I don't really know at this point. But one thing I do know is I can continue to focus on greater and greater clarity and insight into all this, greater and greater clarity. No matter what. And continue to focus on managing success. It will come. As long as I keep focusing on managing success, success will come. Not success in terms of helping God win a contest, but success in towards vision of seeing everything is uncontestable. There's nothing that can truly be contested at all. Being awareness cannot be contested. There's nothing that can obscure it. So again, this hearing this, getting used to hearing this is very helpful because you'll hear more and more of it. This is the crux of the situation. This is the crux of what we need to hear. And the more comfortable you get with this, the easier it is for you to get into it. And then the easier it is for you to have insights yourself and say, "Oh, I see it. Wow." And then realize, "Oh, I'm in comfortable territory. This isn't too difficult for me. I'm not in over my head. I'm not in over my head." When I saw this, I was elation, but I didn't feel in over my head really, no. I said, "Okay, great. This is very helpful." Now, I can say this carefully, if I can try to say it. In an instance where I was abiding in the non-dual, uncontested, uncontestable awareness, eventually I got pulled out of it, as it were, into the belief that contestment was possible through, how did I do it? Well, I saw this group of people who were carrying these banners of light. They're the light workers, the light people. And they said, "Hey, come with us. Look over." They're so enthusiastic. They said, "We are on the brink of great success. We are really on the brink of finally winning, finally defeating the darkness." And I saw that they were looking at this darkness and they were putting together this huge gathering to finally dispel this darkness. And they were so enthusiastic and hopeful that finally we can win against this, what is contesting against us. Finally we can win and win. We're on the side of God, and we'll win for God, and then we'll be rewarded for this. And this is what pulled me out of the non-dual abidance, and vision of uncontestability. Is there the enthusiasm of the light workers is what caused the problem. And so there are a ton of light workers in the world. Those who call themselves the various ways, those who feel that they're bringing the light and dispelling the darkness and defeating it once and for all. Okay, this is the heart of dualism, actually. This is the heart of self-deception. This is what has to be seen through. This is the height of arrogance, to say that there's something that needs to be defeated before what? You mean uncontestability isn't true right now? Something has to be defeated first? That is the heart of arrogance and self-delusion. Nothing has to happen at all, because God is not being contested at all right now. There's no contestment. There's no possibility of God ever being contested. So what has to happen first before that is true? Does anything have to happen first in order to make that true? Before it can become true? To reveal it as true, really? I mean, it's already revealed as true. We just need to put our attention on that. We don't have to win any contest to do that. This is just dropping our arrogance, is all we have to do. We don't have to defeat some arrogance. Defeat? Arrogance is our own position that contestment is possible. So we just repent of that. There's not anything outside of ourselves that we have to struggle with or defeat. We're not in any contest at all, really. We just have to accept the fact that we've never been in any contest. In fact, contestment is impossible. It's always been impossible. Now, we might be getting frightened and say, no, I want to be on the winning side. I want to be on the winning side. There is no such thing. If there's no contest, how can we be on a winning side? Side means duality. I want to be on the side that wins. It means there's another side. But there are no sides to God. There are no sides to pure spaciousness. It's uncontestable. How can there be sides? And now we may say, well, there's no opportunity before. Right, no opportunity for what? Well, to prove myself to God. Nothing needs to prove itself to God. All is God. What do we need to prove ourselves for? To be included in pure spaciousness? No. Everything is intrinsically included as pure spaciousness. There's nothing that needs to be proven. We say, well, I need the opportunity to show I'm a light worker, that I can defeat the evil. There's no such opportunity. There's no need for any such opportunity. God shares itself with all equally, always, already. Nothing has to happen first for this to be so. So all of this bears repeating over and over and over and over and over and over as much as we can. So it gradually sinks in. This is what our grade five teachers have told us, is that it gradually sinks in. It gradually sinks in. You just have to keep on, keep at it. Gradually it sinks in. It soaks in gradually, like a sponge. We soak it in. Gradually the sponge relaxes. It's you know, set condition, like a dry sponge. It's not flexible. It's not relaxed. It's tight, right? And gradually the sponge relaxes until it's all peaceful and blissful, so to speak, saturated with awareness of truth. So again, it bears repeating over and over and over and over and over for many, many different angles. So we don't tire of hearing it. I never tire of hearing it, really. Hardly ever. I always want to hear the truth. I've always been that way. Just as much as possible, I try to listen to the truth, and I don't seem to get tired of it. It's like a beautiful song that you just want to hear over and over and over and over again. Every time you hear it, you say, it sounds better than ever. So do not be disturbed if intellectually you cannot, you think, okay, I've done it, I've heard the words, that's it. No, this has to be sink in to our recognition, to our arrogance, to our recognition, to our fear, to touch upon the root of it all and relax the base of our, resistance. The intellect is very superficial in that way. So, we may seem to be stupid to the intellect. So the intellect said, well, I already heard that. I got it. It's a matter of letting it sink in as deeply as possible. What do you mean, I got it? We're trying to get it again and again and again as much as possible. The intellect wants to get it once and say, okay, that's it. So it's a real obstruction, isn't it, in terms of the path. It interferes with us because, again, we want to hear it 10 times. We want to hear it 100 times. We want to get to the wow, get to the wow, get to the wow, get to the wow. The intellect wants to avoid the wow. Because the importance of the intellect is shown is not very important once we see the wow. The intellect is very superficial, and the intellect wants it to seem very important to us. So it wants to prevent the wow, so it doesn't like repetition. It doesn't like practice at all. The intellect hates practice. And we all have this trouble, don't we? We certainly do. The intellect's always saying, God, I don't practice. I don't need to practice. I'm working on my golf swing. I practice, 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 and gradually I notice more and more and more and more and more. It gets better and better and better and better and better. Just keep working on balance. So it's an analogy for the spiritual path. I'm not even hitting any golf balls at all. Not at all. Just swinging the club. But just becoming aware, okay, do it like this, this is better, do it like this, it's better, repeat, 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 repeat. Keep your balance, keep, make the inside of your feet from the toes, dig your toes in, and the balls of your feet and the sides of your feet all the way to your heels. Imagine that you have cleats on them, they're the roots, it's rooted to the ground, it's grown roots right into the ground, you can't move off the inside of your feet there. And this keeps you on the inside edge of your feet and keeps your balance very, very well. You're not swaying, or you're not swaying forward or backward or side to side. Arch the back a bit so you're not leaning over too much. Keep the posture, right posture. Don't, and then keep the balance back. Keep the left arm straight going back, really straight. Even lock the elbow so it keeps it totally straight. Get the club head back as far as possible in your swing, as far back from you as possible. And then don't be in a hurry. Keep your eyes on exactly where you want to hit. Don't break your wrist too soon. Just have this little delay there. And then the purpose is then to just come through just like a whip. And then whip at the very last second, you whip your wrist through. You whip your arm and the wrist right through. Just whoo, happens so fast like that. You do it right, you'll come to it just the right follow through. Keep your balance there. So I practice balance like standing on this foam cylinder. You can buy them at stores for rolling on your back, etc. Foam. I stand on it with my shoes, and I rock back and forth and try to keep my balance. It's a balance exercise like that. Flexibility, all this stuff. Gradually, the strength and the core gets better. So it's like we're using an analogy for exercise. The core is getting stronger and stronger and stronger. Doing the jump rope, everything I do, it's helping strengthen the core. And the stronger the core is, and the better the balance is, the better the swing is going to be ultimately. Not every swing is going to be great, but the overall sample size from a big sample is going to be much, 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 much better. So again, so hearing the spiritual truth, overall, we're getting further and further and further along. Towards vision, absolutely towards abiding in vision. Maybe not today, maybe not tomorrow, but we're getting closer and closer and closer. It's becoming more and more and more and more of a likelihood and more acceptable to us, really. Just like a really good golf swing, you have to let it become more and more acceptable to us that I can swing this way. I really have this really good swing. Because I've been working at it. Now, if we get out on the course and you have the swing, people say, wow, might be intimidating to them. Now, it's much easier for someone who is super persevering, super dedicated, who's been super dedicated to grooving their swing. It's easy for them to swing bad than it is for someone who has no dedication to swing really good, like someone who is dedicated, has had the dedication. So in this world, it's so easy to get pulled down because the people who are down can't pull themselves up by their bootstraps. But it's better to keep the good swing, keep the abidance in vision of uncontestability, of sameness. So it points out the fruit of dedication so others can be inspired. We have to point out the fruits of dedication. And of course, those who want the challenge will love that. And of course, those who don't won't like it. That is true. You can play with, like in golf, you play with someone's really good and someone else is not. And some people just can't take that. They can't stand it. They want the ones who are good to come down to their level and play poorly and make them feel better. But for me, it's like, I say, no. I try to say, wow, just keep inspiring me. I love it. I love it. I'm really inspired by this, by your dedication. Obviously, you're very dedicated. And there's no other way to reach this realization except through dedication. There's no other way because it requires tremendous repetition, practice, attention, patience, all the tools, the virtues, the mental virtues. It requires all of those. Dedication, dedication, dedication. So I present myself as a example of dedication, as I've tried to do with all these videos showing how dedicated I am and how dedicated we need to be to reach what the goal we must reach. And of course the world thinks, no, as soon as we win, then we get the prize. No, the prize is realizing there is no contest to win. That's where you get the prize. And they say, well, what are you talking about? I say, what? It's too difficult. Come down to our level. That makes us feel better. No, in the short term, it might give a little relief. I say, oh, good, I don't have to be determined. But it doesn't go any further than that. And they still are going down a dead end and suffering, being, feeling contested, that their being is being contested, that they are ultimately vulnerable to annihilation, to losing. Who wants to stay in that delusional state of mind? So only through determination do we finally rid ourselves of this arrogance. Finally accept the vision of uncontestability. So the models of determination need to speak up and show themselves the world, which is what I have done. Jesus says, if you are one of those determined ones, then by all means, you must show others showcase it. Don't hide it under a bushel. Let others know that this is the example, that you're setting a good example for everyone. This is how I feel. I've set a good example for everyone in the world through simply determination. Very determined. And, you know, most of the world is hoping, well, I hope that hope he fails, because then it means I don't have to be determined, and I just have to go along and get those robots to win the war for us, and it's all good. I don't have to do anything. So, you know, there's that, like, I don't want to have to be determined, really? Yeah, really, that's what we have to do, and the more inspired we are, the better we can get after it. But it's really better than doing anything else in this world. Absolutely it is. The other stuff in this world is really just a waste of time. By and large, it's very much a waste of time. It's just frittering away our lives. Just hoping that someone will win, some hero will come along and win the battle, some savior will come along and defeat evil. You know, we just wait, suffer, get sick, eat, wait, get sick, indigestion, eat, wait, you know, sleep, work. I was hoping that, okay, I'm praying for a savior, I'm praying, please, I need a savior, help, come on, please, I can't win this contest, I need a help, savior, come along and to win the contest for me and be that champion and the hero. And I prayed so much, I've got no answers. Oh my gosh, this is terrible. How come I don't get an answer, God? This never works. This never works, of course. This is not determination. This is just idly, lazily waiting, hoping for what's impossible to happen. That's just arrogance. We are told we must take the spiritual path of practicing, not waiting. Not waiting for a savior to come in and win the imaginary battle that we're imagining. The Savior is the one that tells you there is no battle. There is no contest. And so this is a very different paradigm than what we're used to. So it takes a great bit of determination to change our paradigm, change our outlook, change our belief system, change our perspective, change our expectations. Tremendous effort of determination to do this. And it's a simple thing. It's just like the golf swing. But I've been working on the golf swing for, like, I don't know, 40 years. How come it's taken so long? I don't know. It's just we have wrong ideas, and we want it to work this way or that way, and it doesn't. You know, you've got to get it just right. It's amazing. It's sad that it. In the golf land, there's just massive amounts of advice and trainers and teachers and techniques and gadgets, and everybody so obsessed with their swing and equipment. And of course, everybody has different ideas of this and that. And it's just never ending in instruction. But really, what they never really get down to is just the basic determination and hard work. Have to work on your flexibility, have to work on your balance, have to work on your core. work on the posture, work on all the elements, everything that goes into it, to the jump rope. How many people are jumping rope now? Probably, I've asked a lot of people now. Nobody. I'm the only one I know that jumps rope. It's a very, very helpful exercise. The Holy Spirit told me you need to jump rope. It came about in very funny ways of people having this a bunch of rope tied, loop tied. Give me that. And they said, here's some rope for you. You need this rope. This is your rope. I said, well, it's not my rope. He says, yeah, it is. I think it is. A bundle of rope. And I said, no. And they said, no, here. And he threw it in my truck, threw it in the vehicle and said, here, this is your rope. What? And then it happened again. Oh, here's your rope. Here's your rope, rope, rope. Rope. I could say, rope? Why? Everybody's giving me this rope. I have to have this rope. And then I realized, oh my gosh, the Holy Spirit's talking to me and saying, you need to jump rope. Start jumping rope. Oh, wow. Really? I did yesterday. I had to knock out 250 late in the evening at nighttime. And boy, that really got me. I was winded and tough. And everybody say jump rope is really great exercise. This will help your golf game. This will help this. And they say, oh yeah, yeah, it's great. It's a wonderful exercise. Okay, a lot of people say that. Oh yeah, this is fabulous exercise, jump rope. I say, well, do you do it? Do you do it? Oh no, not right now. No. Did you try it? Yeah, well, someone tried. Oh, it's too difficult. No, I can't do it. So everyone will agree that's really great, but they won't do it. So a lot of people will agree, oh, spiritual path, yeah, this is non-dual, it's tremendous, that's great. But who will actually do it? Who's actually doing it? Now for me, I want to see that golf ball go out there. I want to see it fly. I want to see, that's what I want. I want to see that. So I keep working at it. Because the times when I do it, just, really launch it and let it fly, it's like, it's done. It's sort of like, I don't have to do anything. I don't have to do anything. Everything's okay. It's all okay. No worries, no troubles. You'll sort of feel this feeling of uncontestment, no contestment. So, for whatever reason, we have to be determined. We really want enlightenment. We really want the vision of oneness. We really want it. And then, therefore, then we just, whatever it takes, we'll do. If it means jumping rope, then that's what I gotta do. If it means taping, that's what I gotta do. If it means repeating, going over and over this, that's what I gotta do. There's no shortcut. We just have to be determined. There's no shortcut to determination. Determination is just saying, whatever I gotta do, that's what I'm doing. And most people are waiting for some savior. They think, oh, well, some guru will come along, some sage saint, and they'll do it for me. No, they won't. Because we have to accept there's never been a contest. Never will be. And if we're not willing to do that, then what we're doing is we're saying someone's got to come along and win the contest for me. A hero or a heroine has to come along and win the contest for me. This makes our arrogance and self-delusion even worse. Even worse. So we may think that, oh, I'm not getting worse. Oh, yes, we are. If that's what our belief is, we're getting worse. Our delusion is getting worse. And hitting a great drive is like synonymous to like ascension. I feel, to me, it symbolizes ascension. It's like we get the escape velocity to go to another realm, so to speak. Broken free of this world. What is that? Yeah. It just somehow, you know, you hit it right in the backspin, and it goes, and you realize, ah, escape velocity, escape velocity. That one's going 300 yards or so. If you hit, you know, you just, oh, okay, I can do it. I can get it. I can do it. I can get it right. So occasionally, when you hit one like that, it's like similar to having glimpses of a vision of oneness, vision of spaciousness, the vision of sameness, vision of uncontestability. It's similar. You think, wow, that was easy. How come I can't do that every time? So what I've tried to do is I've tried to, you know, just work on grooving it so I can feel like I can do this pretty much every time. There's no reason why I cannot. It's the same, similar to, I want to abide in the vision of sameness. Not just glimpse it occasionally, but actually abide in it permanently. And to do that, we have to avoid the savior trap, don't we? Or the enthusiasm trap of, hey, we've got the forces now. The light forces are strong enough now to finally defeat the evil. We must avoid that trap. We must avoid the savior trap. If there's nothing that God needs to be saved from, there's nothing that we need to be saved from either. Except the delusion that there's something to be saved from. And we certainly don't succeed at that by defeating something. You know, that just exacerbates it, the delusion. That's interesting. I say, today is not a good day to play golf. It's clearing up. I don't know if it will, but you know, it'll give a false picture because it's real cold and can't, no flexibility, and it's just, yeah, but it'll give a bad impression to me, bad feedback, all the work I've done, very bad feedback. And maybe the world is actually a very bad place right now to be for the vision of uncontestability, because it's such a harsh place right now as far as being arrogant. Egoically arrogant, that you won't get the right feedback. Everybody will just say, you know, ignore you, think you're terrible, crazy, whatever. Maybe it's not such a good idea to remain here, you know, for a long time. I don't know. Wait for things to get warmer, just like for golf. Wait for, like, you know, summertime where it's real nice and you really hit a good drive. It's gonna fly. Right now, this wind and the cold is gonna knock it down. And you think, oh, something wrong with my swing. There's nothing wrong with my swing, but the conditions are very harsh here. So, similar in the world, conditions are very harsh right now. I've just, you know, maybe so harsh that we have to wait until they, you know, soften up a little bit. The enthusiasm, you know, of hey, we've got the upper hand on darkness, on evil, on badness, and we're about ready to triumph and win. This is insanity. This is what is opposite, this is what is opposed to spiritual path in terms of realization. It's saying there's opposition, where spiritual truth says there's no opposition. It's a perspective which keeps us from recognizing the true perspective, right? So there's no contest between the two, because we're saying that there's no contest. So how can there be a contest between this and that? There isn't. But we can get pulled into the belief there is, if people are super adamant here. I think that there has to be a contest, and they're in a contest with us, or we're in a contest with them. No, we're not in any contest with anything. Nothing is in any contest. Nothing is contestable. There's no contestability at all. We see it. We can see it. There might be very little interest in this in the world at this time. It seems to be. So like a cold winter's day, like the day, why go out and play golf and get a wrong impression of your game? Why not go out when it's 85 and the air is light and rising and clear and you hit it right and it just flies true? And then you say, wow, my swing is really grooved. This is the swing that works. This swing really works. Just like this realization really works. This is the one that really works. Again, this is just a theory that I have, that's possible theory, that indeed the world is really bottoming out and going into a severely too much trouble mode, as I call it. Again, I had this very dramatic situation arise with where this woman, and you know, it was hard to tell if she was a woman or a man, actually. And some of the women actually came up to me after and said, I couldn't tell if that was a woman or a man. They couldn't even tell hardly, but they said, well, I guess it's a woman. Yeah, it was. But very difficult to tell the difference. It really was, and who was just out of her mind, completely messed up on drugs, and just her mental state was just, you know, bizarre. And I wanted to help her. I go over and talk with her, and I said, maybe I can, you know, witness to her and help her out. And something inside me said, no. This is too much trouble for you right now. This is too much trouble. Just sidestep it. So I did. I just took safe harbor. Took safe harbor in this nice store. And then the police came and dealt with it. And they finally just left her alone because they couldn't really make heads or tails. She was just rambling this way and that way and making all sorts of excuses and really so. This is too much trouble. So this world, I believe, it's certainly presenting itself as too much trouble, which justifies sidestepping it and waiting for another time to witness, to do a real strong witnessing here. I believe if we try to do a real strong witnessing here right now, we're going to get a very false impression of our realization, and we're going to think, well, maybe it's not quite it, which is not true. Vision of sameness is it. All these teachers have said that it is. And in the right conditions, the right feedback we get, people say, oh, thank you, I'm inspired by your determination, and I can have faith in what you're saying, I'm going to work at it. And then you get the feedback that, you know, yeah, even though we know it's true, the feedback helps, and too much trouble is still possible for us. It really is. Because it can be made to seem like that we're in a contest with them over this issue, when we're really not in any contest at all. We say truth cannot be contested at all. So we're just in an inspirational mode, not in a contestment mode. But they may take it like as a contest because they're so into winning against something, you know, whether it's climate, you know, whether it's overpopulation, whether it's poverty, whether it's equality, whether it's this issue. They're really into winning. We gotta win, we gotta win, we gotta win. And it's just illusions tussling with other illusions, actually. God doesn't need us to win anything. Truth is uncontestable. How could there be a contest? It has to be a fake contest entirely. It has to be a totally fake contest. Total contrivance, total pretense, and that's all it is. So, I don't know what's coming for me. I really don't at this point. I just said. And this is part of the wow. It's like, wow, this changes everything so much. I don't know how it's going to go. How, you know, I don't know what to expect. This is part of the stress of the path is when we establish a new normal. We're not quite sure what to expect going forward. It's new to us. Just like looking at YouTube, going through all these various channels and then looking at comments on them, wow, people are so messed up here. It's just, good grief. The best, you know, I get great comments here and also great no comments, which is nice. Sometimes it's best to just no comment, but I certainly appreciate the comments, a lot of them. But my most of the videos on YouTube, good Lord. Very depressing. But again, there's no savior that's going to come into this world and defeat the enemy for you, for anyone. They're going to tell you, like Jesus said, God is love. They said, what's wrong with you, Jesus? I thought you were going to come to help us defeat the enemy. No, 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 love your enemy. He said, what? What are you talking about? You're crazy. Yeah. So there is no such savior to come in and defeat anyone. The saviors are the ones that come and say, there isn't any contest. There never has been. And you can see this fact. You need to see this fact. It's not enough to hear the words. You have to actually see it. And it's not enough to see it for a little while, because if you stop seeing it, then you'll think, okay, well, the contest has started. Okay, there was no contest for a while, but now there's a contest taking place. This is when you lose the vision of oneness, is being suckered back into the belief that it's being contested somehow. Vision of oneness is actually just seeing that nothing is contesting its own intrinsic spaciousness. Oh, it's cold. We're not going to mind it warming up here, I'll tell you that. I would say it's chilly. When it's cold, it rained. The rain, the moisture is evaporating. The air is full of moisture, and it's real cold. And then the wind, there's a wind blowing that cold air on you, cold moist air. That's chilly, and it's real chilly right now. It's not real chilly. Like the world is a very chilly place right now. It's got very chilly towards truth because they're obsessed with winning. Why don't all the politicians just say, hey, the truth, hey, guess what? We're all going to decide together that none of us are going to run, because there's nothing that needs to be won, nothing that needs to be done. We can realize the truth of God right here, right now, so let's all do that instead. Is that going to happen tomorrow? Would the population allow that, or would they freak out completely? Say, no, we must have a savior, a leader that leads us into battle, helps us win the battles that we need to win. That's what they're looking for. So certainly we need to stay in touch with truth. We need to stay in touch with this. Keep our literacy alive. Keep our literacy alive. Keep the goal. Keep the eye on the prize. Keep the eye on the prize. Great example, of course, is Jesus coming 2,000 years ago to Judea and Galilee, but in the Holy Land. And people saying, here's the Messiah, here's the Messiah. And then others saying, wait a minute, you know, we want a king, like King David, to come back and to drive everybody away, that you know, get the law back, get our law reestablished strongly everywhere, defeat all our enemies, get all the kingdoms, all the tribes united, and be the central world power, that our laws are always respected and nobody can say otherwise, and spread the truth about our legalism and our laws and our ways, and we want this great savior king so we can be rulers of the world. And they said, Jesus isn't doing that. He's not come here to defeat our enemies. What is that? How can he be the Messiah? You're crazy. That's not a Messiah. That's a joke. I mean, we can't have him spreading his gospel around, and because we'll lose faith in the Messiah. So there were those who were severely rejecting of Jesus, for sure. But for me, I can't help but feel like I'm in for something good, really good. I can't help but feel that way. The world is still trying to beat me up as much as it can. There's no question about that. Wow. But at some point here, I'm going in the right direction. At some point, the fruit will be available, and we can pick the fruit of this, no question about it. But it won't be as the Savior that wins the battle. That's what will not happen. That's what will not happen. That will never happen. There's no battle to be won. So how can that happen? There's nothing that needs to be done first in order to experience perfect peace right now. Absolutely nothing. And it's only in realizing this that we'll experience it. Otherwise, we'll try to be doing something other, trying to win somehow, do something else first. So keep jumping your rope. I was up at about 12:30 last night just doing hundreds of converting these graphics from BMP to JPEG because Flickr won't take BMP. And it's very tedious. I have another 100 to do still. But just, you know, I just said, wow, I'm doing this for Jesus. Let me keep doing it. He deserves it. He's telling us the truth. So certainly he deserves whatever hand, you know, however we can help him bring this good news. It's not the good news of winning a contest. It's the good news that there is no contest to win. We don't have to help God win any contest. We don't have to help God win any contest. God is not, did not put us, take, make this world, put us in this world and say, look, you've got to help me win this contest. I'm in trouble. None of that is true. And we don't have to think like, oh, if I don't help God win the contest, then God will turn his back on me. None of that is true. There is no contest. There's nothing we need to do. But only in accepting this will we see God as God really is. Which is to drop our arrogance. Not seeing God as God is arrogance. Oh, I might need a down jacket this winter. I mean, you know, that would help. We haven't had no need for down jackets here for so long. Everybody wears them anyway because it's the chic thing to do. It says, look, I can afford a down jacket, is what it really is. Everybody loves to wear the badges of their material success, right? So, but this winter it would be helpful. I used to, when I was young, just wear a t-shirt all winter. I said, shorts, t-shirt, I'm not going to change. I don't care what the weather is. I used to really be in a battle with the weather. I said, you're not going to get me to believe that any of this is true, any of this bad weather is true. No way. I believe every day is going to be perfect. So I'd always look and see, okay, I think the perfect weather's coming. It should be, it's right around the bend here. It's right around the bend. Any moment now, it's going to be really nice and warm and beautiful. And some people in California, they do that. They wear shorts all winter. They don't bundle up. I even see them wearing sandals. Barefoot sandals and all through winter. Yeah. Shorts, sandals, and t-shirt. They're not going to give in to it. They say, well, tomorrow I know it's going to be great. So spiritually, we must not give in to any of the coldness of this world. Say, look, I know really soon I'm going to be in bliss and peace of uncontestable vision of uncontestability. Not that I'm defending against contestment, it's just that inherently contestment is impossible. Okay? It's not a matter of defending it at all. So people like pull us out of abidance and the vision of sameness by saying, well, how are you defending yourself? Jesus says, my safety lies in my defenselessness. Is recognizing there isn't anything that can be contested. There's no need to defend against contestment. I'm not feeling peaceful and blissful because I've found a successful defense against being attacked. It's as I'm seeing that nothing can be attacked. Everything is just pure spaciousness. How can that be attacked? It can't be attacked. So I'm abiding because I see there's nothing that needs defense. So going through these graphics, each one has a lesson in A Course in Miracles. Some of them, you know, I just, wow, it's great. Not all of them resonate with me the same intensity. That's to be expected. But some of them just resonate very strongly. I tend to, when I think of vision and breakthroughs in God, I tend to think of pure spaciousness because that's how I experienced it very profoundly, more than like light, like white light or something. Jesus talks a lot about the light. Longchenpa talks more about the spaciousness. I tend to, at this point, seem that the spaciousness seems to resonate with me stronger than the metaphor of like light, using the term light. Of course, the light is clear light, so it's the same pure spaciousness, clear light. It's all one. But you know, the emphasis can be different. Different teachers emphasize it different ways. Jesus said, "God is the light in which I see." I'm sort of getting that. But it's still a little foggy in terms of the terminology. Longchenpa's terminology, I tend to get that a little more directly. Like I say, okay, yeah, wow. But some of Jesus's, what he says, also, I tend to get it very directly too. But he says a lot. Jesus says so much that there might be some stuff that the emphasis, it doesn't seem quite clear to you. Not a little bit more uncertain than other stuff. But maybe I just say, oh, it's okay. It's not a problem. It'll all come out in the wash just fine. But he says, you'll start seeing edges of light around stuff. I've never seen that. And when Longchenpa says, well, you'll see that everything is just an intrinsic, it's a decoration of its own intrinsic spaciousness. That seems like, oh, it's easy to see that. It's very easy. I feel like that's easy. I get that. I've never seen edges of light around anything. I haven't seen that yet. I haven't seen that sort of what Jesus talks about. And I feel this is one way of perceiving it. But I feel that the spaciousness also is a way of perceiving it. It's almost like an absence of perception. Like you're perceiving an absence of perception. And it probably would almost feel like that. A lack of emphasis upon perception, which then enables to see the spaciousness there, be aware of the spaciousness there. It's just a little shift in emphasis. This is what I found. I was able to do that a couple of years ago, to make the shift into the vision of oneness. And it was just a little shift of emphasis is all that's required. And I've been trying to do that ever since without success, really. Because we're looking for something bigger that we can say, look what I did to help you, God. You know, look how I won this contest. I say, what? Just that little shift? That's not anything. That's not any winning. That's not winning a contest. I didn't do anything. It was just a slight shift in emphasis between perception and absence of perception. That's all that it is. It's all it is what I've experienced is just a very subtle little shift in emphasis. I'm willing to see spaciousness more than form, so to speak. I'm willing to emphasize the spaciousness over the form. Just a little more emphasis. And right away, I became aware of the spaciousness. Just like that. It's that simple. Of course, when that happens, we say, oh, hallelujah, I got to tell everybody. And then we run into a buzzsaw. And then we start feeling doubts about ourselves. So I've had to go back and make the context clearer and clearer and clearer so I don't get knocked off track. It's similar with the golf swing. Let's say you swing just right and you say, wow, that's great, easy. And then you start forgetting, all these swing thoughts might get into your head and before you know it, you're all messed up again because you don't really know your swing. But if you really know your swing, I know how to do it right, then it's easier to do it over and over and over again. The same thing with what we're doing. If we really know the context, then it's easier just to remain in abidance. Very easy to remain in abidance. And realize it's just a subtle little emphasis. It's not really winning any contest at all. And that's exactly what all we need to do. We need to realize we don't need to do anything. Other than there's just a little, and that helps us shift our emphasis onto spaciousness, realization. There's nothing we need to do. We don't need to help God win a contest. It enables us to emphasize spaciousness more, which is uncontestability, and see the and then we'll see. We're willing to see the uncontestability, but we still see plants and everything else still there. But we realize it's not interfering with spaciousness at all. It's not contesting it at all. But just a little shift in emphasis is all that's required. Like the golf swing, I know I'm keeping my arm straight instead of bending it. When I make a mistake, I bend the left arm a little bit, and I realize that brings mistakes into the swing. It lowers the overall results, actually. But by keeping it straight, I have a much better, more consistent swing. Not doing too full of a swing makes it a lot easier. You know, not really cocking the wrist too much makes it a lot more repeatable. A lot of different stuff. You realize, okay, if I do it this way, it's very repeatable. Very repeatable. Very effective and repeatable. And if I try to do other ways, it eventually starts to get the wheels start coming off. And I might have some good results, some bad, and it's uneven. So when we see spaciousness, we see just a little willingness to perceive uncontestability. That's all it is. We don't need to get more complicated than that at all. Keep it very simple. Just like the golf swing, I'm keeping it very simple right now. Really, really simple. And thus it becomes very repeatable. But in order to keep it simple, you have to have a lot of core strength in order to generate the power. Part of the problem that everyone has is they don't have enough overall strength to keep this thing swing simple and short. So they end up having to do way too much movement and sway and do all this stuff. And then in order to get the power, the speed, and then that throws a lot of variables into it. And it's not really repeatable. And they may hit a few good and then a lot terrible, which undermines their confidence. But if you get the core, everything real strong, what I've found is I can keep the swing real short real simple, real short, and still generate great club head speed. And that's really the aim. That's what you really want. I mean, if you really asked anyone, they'd say, wow, if I could just have a real simple short swing and still generate great club head speed, that's the way to go. Makes the game simple, right? You just very confident. Oh, I can hit it out there plenty far without just a simple short swing. A lot of the pros have that, actually. They're able to do that. And some of them have such tremendous core and balance, etc. They end up still taking a long swing, but they can keep it all together, and they generate tremendous club head speed. But for us, you know, we it's better to keep it very simple. Really, for the pros, it's just about getting that wrist cock. If they want to do a lot of that, they might be able to generate a little bit more torque and a little more speed that way. Not a lot, actually. But that introduces a lot of variable possibilities for messing up, too. It really does. So do we really need just a little bit more speed? Probably not. Not for our purposes, we don't. Just like we don't need to know at all. We just need to see vision of uncontestability. Just see uncontestability, which is what? Pure spaciousness. Just see that. That's all. It's all we need to do is just see that. And we can see it. I've seen it. And it's just that everyone in the world wants to know, well, how did you do it? How did you win? I didn't win anything. I was just willing to see that there's nothing to win. And this is where the rubber meets the road. And they say, what? You're crazy. What are you talking about? I don't understand what you're talking about. Can you explain to me better? I mean, what they're really saying is, well, you must be holding some secrets back of how to win. I say, no, I was willing to recognize, drop my arrogance, realize that God cannot be contested. There's no contestment. So I'm just willing to see this fact. This is what is really cures me from delusion. But they still think, no, there's just really, if I'm okay, what do I need to do to get the answer from you? You know, and then they, oh, you want me to do this, you want me to do that, and then you get in this whole dance of madness with them. There's no holding back. they just can't believe. They have to be very, very determined to change their belief system. That's all. And is there a culture that supports this determination? No, there's not. And right now in this world, this is the trouble. So even if people say, well, you want to be determined, say, oh, it's too difficult. There's no support in this culture for that. This culture is in support of severe contestment. I mean, Silicon Valley is a perfect example of that. We have all the best and the brightest here from all over the world, right? All the tech companies are looking for the brightest, best people possible, and the money's insane. But they're just like competing like crazy with one another. Everybody's frantically feels, and you talk to these people, they say, oh my God, my life is just insane. I mean, I can't hardly keep up. This is just, they're just, it's such a struggle here. The drive is struggle. Everything's a struggle, intense struggle here. Contestment. Are people happy? No, they're not happy here. But they think they're on the road to happiness, that maybe they'll find it here. Early retirement. Somebody have found early retirement. That's what they're really after. They really are after that. Make their untold millions and retire before they're 30. I hear people, someone say, oh yeah, he's retired. I say, well, 20 something, you know, 30 or whatever. They're retired. What? And people here seem to think that that's like no big deal. Retire by the time you're 30. That's like the norm for them. That's what they think. So in the meantime, they're like just frantic to win. So that culture does not support the kind of patient determination that's required to change our belief system and to be willing to see that there's nothing that can be contested. Reality is uncontestable. And there's nothing we need to do to make it that way. It's inherently that way. The determination to change our belief system is very much helped by culture, or a certain culture of slow-paced, relaxed attitude. You can just sit wherever you are, it's okay. Nobody says, hey, move along, come on. We want a culture of winning here. Win, 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 win. It's pretty much the American culture, isn't it? Win, win, win at everything. So it's very difficult. And the whole world is really caught up in this. Go, 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 go. We're under threat, under threat, under threat, under threat. We have to win. The only way we can be happy is win, win, win. The only way we can be happy is realize that there's no contest at all. That's the only way we can be happy, actually. So if I go out there and try to convince people, they'd say, well, but look, yeah, it's great, but the culture doesn't support it at all. I would just fall into homelessness or something. I mean, the Silicon Valley, the housing, it's insane. The prices here, everything is insanely expensive. You cannot believe it. You have to be a millionaire just to survive here. And so people are just clawing and scratching, trying to get by here. They'll kick you out of your apartment and say, we're going to double the rent. And they're trying. The landlords are trying to get as much as possible from all these rich tech people. Everybody's after that money. And if you don't have the money, you know. So, yeah. And in general, the world is you know, becoming economically and politically obsessed. We're obsessed with all this winningness. Now, I pretend like I'm interested. You have to sort of pretend. So I watch a game, watch sports. Oh yeah, something such a one, but. You know, it's like, I don't really care. It's not important, really. I mean, if it's entertaining, that's nice. Super Bowl's coming. Will I watch the Super Bowl? No. Super Bowl's just like about 20 miles away from here. Have I paid any attention to it? No. Haven't paid the slightest bit of attention to it. There's all this hoopla 24 hours a day on the all the media. It's always that way. Just massive stuff going on with it. You know, there's a big buzz, but have I? Nobody I've talked to is interested in it here. You know, I've asked a lot. I say, what about the Super Bowl? What do you think? Nobody's interested in it here that I've talked to. They're just trying to survive monetarily here. But so I'm not going to watch the Super Bowl. Doubtful. But if I happen to be somewhere, I might watch a couple plays or something. What's going on? Okay, whatever. But in Rome, do as Rome. You can't, if you act like you have no interest in contestment whatsoever here, then you're very suspect. Trying to collapse the culture, they think you're just a saboteur or something. So I stay up on sports a little bit so I can chit chat about it. Now maybe the ladies stay up on fashion a little bit so they can chit chat about that. You know, similar thing. They may not be really into it at all. You know, someone says, oh, did you see what so-and-so was wearing? What do you think about that? Oh, I don't like that. Or so that was really cute. Or I think she should have accessorized this way. So even a little better. So it's like for sports, same thing with men and some women. And for women, maybe they need to stay up on something like fashion or whatever. That's okay. Make it seem like, you know, you're still up on the fashion contest, which really is contestment. Who... But you may not really be that in, you don't really care about it. You really don't care. Deep down, you don't care at all. You're working on the spiritual path. That's fine. That's fine. Again, in this modern culture, I think we have to at least pretend a little bit like we're into winning in some way. People think I watch television on sports, but actually, I watch about 5 minutes a week. That's not really watching television, is it? I watch a little Golden State Warriors. I watch Steph Curry because he puts on quite a show. You're bound to see something you've never seen before. He's a real entertainer. Yeah, that's a little wild. I say, okay, all right, and then that's it. That's it. Shut it off. That's it. Go back to Longchampa or Jesus, right? Just like that. So don't be don't think that you have to be look like some spiritual person here. You know, the culture doesn't allow it. And don't think that just because you seem like you fit in with the world, that means you're not spiritual, you're not on the path. It doesn't mean that at all. You may just be pretending to fit in, going along to get along a little bit, so you don't seem so suspect, because you're focusing on no winning, nothing, there's no contestment. You're not focusing on losing, you're focused on seeing, truth is uncontestable. There is no contest. That's what you're focusing on. That's what we're focusing on here. This is genuine non-dual teaching here. It's genuine non-dual teaching here. And we're getting to it. We're really focusing and getting to it. Look at this breeze. Wow, it's very intense. It's flat out windy or gusty and windy right now. Oh, good Lord. Playing golf in this weather would be just a nightmare. Really a nightmare. The Holy Spirit told me not to. He said, it's too crowded, too crowded. I said, what do you mean? That would be out there. No, too crowded, too crowded. And maybe the drive home, it'll be an accident or something. It'll be gridlock or something. I don't know. But the Holy Spirit just said, no, too crowded, too crowded. So I got this negative reaction about going out playing golf. No, no, no. I was about ready to do it. And now I'm glad I didn't, because this is really unfriendly weather. How are we doing here? Cruising right along. Oh, it's a low gigabyte count. Maybe I could keep cruising along if I can stand the cold here and keep. What's the benefit? Keep emphasizing. This is the blessing. This is the grace that we have. Anyone who does this is sharing the grace, putting grace into the world. By emphasize, re-emphasize. Spending time on this is grace. We're not just one-off intellectually saying, yeah, this is the non-dual position. Wow. No contest. Okay, there's nothing contestable. Oh, got it. Great. That's, you know, the grace is to say it 1,000 times. And 1,000 more times. And to spend hour after hour after hour after hour on this. This is where it's at. This is what ultimately brings us to the success, not winning success, and not losing success, but saying there isn't any contest where we have to succeed. And so also there can't be any losing either, can there? There's only the vision of uncontestability, vision of pure spaciousness, vision of sameness. And it's just a slight willingness. It's just a shift, a slight shift in our willingness, which is really our arrogance. It means we let go of our arrogance just a little bit. Say, okay, I have this willingness to see that there's nothing I need to do. Nothing is being contested at all. There's no winning possible. There's no losing possible. Just to see this, and then that slight shift in willingness, we will actually see it. The best vision. We will have the vision. And then the question again is how to stay in that. That then becomes the problem for us. And I found it to be, you know, quite difficult. Have to keep practicing and practicing, get stronger and stronger context. And this culture makes it extraordinarily difficult to abide in it. Ram Maharshi was, you know, abided in it for sure. But the culture allowed him to. It defended him. It welcomed him. It celebrated him. It cherished him. It got it. It understood him. I mean, he was just doing it. He just abided. It was an abidance. And people, religious, you know, spiritual, holy religious people and traditions, they said, wow, this is great. Let us give him a place to stay. Let us give him food. Let us protect him. It's okay, it's wonderful that he hangs out here. It's a blessing for us. We really appreciate it. Let's leave him alone. He wants to be left alone. Let's leave him alone. And so the culture, you know, embraced him and cherished him. Makes it way easier. And he was therefore able to just do it to a profound extent. That's testimony to the culture there in southern India at that time. It reflects well upon them. It really does. And, you know, a lot of us have respect for that. I certainly do. Reflects very well upon the culture. Now, a lot has changed in the last 65 years since he passed on, I think, in 1950. A lot has changed, all right, around the world. Terrible change. Where we say, what good is that? He's sitting there doing nothing. He's not helping us win. It's ridiculous. He's just some lazy son of a gun, probably on drugs. This is what people will say now, right? Probably on drugs. Or he's retired or something. I don't see anything value there. It's ridiculous. We want to win. I want to make my millions. I want to be a philanthropist. Come on. I want to help charity. I want to be charitable. Got to help the kids. Come on. I want to win, 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 win. Go fast. I want to get my toys. I want to be a winner. That'll make me happy. So, this is the culture we have now. So, I don't want to be discouraging, but I'm being realistic here. So we really have to, don't be discouraged if we are not abiding in this vision of uncontestability. Don't be discouraged at all. I try not to be discouraged. Sometimes I'm frustrated because I think like I should be able to do this. I should have the will to do this. But then I run into the buzzsaw of the world. It's like, well, can I explain it? Will they understand? No, and of course not. They would say, you had some sort of seizure and your brain isn't functioning anymore. The winning part of your brain has got knocked out. It's poor, terrible. Let's get you on drugs or go see a doctor, you know, or they'll come up with some disparaging perspective for sure. Most will. I don't know where the ones who won't are, actually. And maybe they're pretending to be going along with the flow here. And when they see an opportunity, they may jump at it. This is possible. I don't know. Holy Spirit knows. I don't know. Maybe there's many that they're just pretending to go along. Right? And when they see the opportunity, they will jump at it. This is my hope. They're doing a good job hiding at this point. That is for sure. But you would expect that. You would expect that. This is a time now where those who are genuinely interested have to hide that interest to a large extent. Just like I have to do this taping. And I cannot make any, I can't let people know I'm doing that. That are in my immediate vicinity who would react to it. No, absolutely not. Culture is really brutal. We're in a brutal culture right now. Very archaic, Paleolithic, Stone Age, brutal culture. Barbaric culture. And the yoga girls are the most brutal of all, actually. Really. They say, don't worry, we'll help you win. You didn't win before, you didn't win because we weren't here, but now that we're here, you're bound to win. This is what's being, this is the attitude of the world. This is what's going on. And this, of course, takes us far astray from the realization that we need to have, right? Far astray from it. So this yoga girl culture may simply be too much trouble for us. I mean, this is what the Holy Spirit has pointed out to me. It's too much trouble. We have to sidestep this one. And, you know, I can certainly see that. You know, I don't like to say, you know, I can't do it. I'm not going to give up trying, you know, to at least, but I certainly see, if that's what the Holy Spirit is pointing out, it seems to be pointing this out. There's no doubt about it, that it's too much trouble. But I'll keep trying to help everyone as long as I'm here. But if the Holy Spirit says, look, it's time to retreat, then I got to retreat. Holy Spirit knows best. It's not going to try to throw me to the wolves. It won't throw any of us to the wolves. Maybe our lack of success is just Holy Spirit saying, I'm not going to throw you to the wolves. No way. So I just have to be patient. I know the teachers are there. I know they have our best interest at heart. I know they're teaching correctly. I know this is the right perspective, the right direction. All of this is right. So just have to be patient and see how it plays out here. But this yoga girl thing is coming on like a steamroller. Just flatten us all out in terms of, don't worry, boys, everyone, here we are. We're the new leadership. We'll lead you to success. We'll lead you to triumph. We are the new light workers. We will finally defeat evil in every guise. We will root it out in every guise possible and crush it. We are the steamroller. You know, this is the height of arrogance and delusion. Self-delusion. Totally inimical to what we're focused on, isn't it? Just a simple vision right here, right now, of pure uncontestability, of God, pure spaciousness. And there's nothing we have to do about it at all. There's nothing we need to win or champion or anything like that. It's just this is what is. This is how it is. Without us having to do anything about it. We don't need to maintain it. We don't need to do anything about it. And accepting this as truth here, and we try to stay abiding in this truth and don't get suckered into falsity. That's where it's at. That's where it's really at. It's interesting that leaf just showed into the video, didn't it? Because the wind was blowing so strongly. What does that mean? Leaving? Leafing? Leaving? We may be leaving soon. I don't know. Ascending? Ascension, again, is certainly doable. This is what I feel. Very doable. You just give commission to your overall mental complex. A vacation. A vacation commission. You no longer need to be in a realm where the contestment is so intense. We go to a reduced intensity realm. Very much reduced intensity realm. Everyone there, they're not really into needing to contest anything. Don't need to get into a group. Together, we're stronger. We're stronger for what? Contesting something? Like this world is so activist. The social media is being used to bring about a great deal of activism. And saying, look, together, we get millions. We can defeat this evil. We can, you know, we can succeed. We can win. We're helping God. We're helping righteousness. We're helping truth. We're helping all that is good. We're self-righteous. So there's a massive self-righteousness in this world that are being led by the yoga girls. So that they're coming on. They will come on strong, believe me. They are, I've seen it all coming. They are on the march. It's been going on for 60 years. They're on the march. They are ready to assume their leadership position and say, everybody, here we are. Now, we're going to show you how to really win. Okay. That's too much trouble. Okay, the yoga girls are too much trouble. And this, you just need to hear this. I can tell you this. Too much trouble. For us, too much trouble. The culture will be, you know, unaccepting, uninviting entirely at that point. They've already got a stranglehold on most spirituality here in this world. Absolutely. I don't know any that they don't have a stranglehold upon, actually. And they're glamorizing everything so much so that people are just like, oh wow, yoga girls, I'm for sure to be happy if we just follow their lead. The spiritualization of delay is what it really is. Now this video, last time it just stopped at about 227 or whatever, even though I still had plenty of gigabytes left, because we're supposed to get 4, so it may just stop soon here. It may just stop soon. So we've certainly said what we need to say here and emphasize it over and over and over. So do not get discouraged if you don't have the vision of oneness, you're not abiding in the vision of uncontestability. And you're pretending to just be, you know, like everybody else in the world, you don't seem to be very spiritual, that's fine. Don't get discouraged. It's understood here, absolutely. I try to fit in, I don't go around trying to appear like I'm some spiritual pilgrim, right? No. I don't go around trying to act like I'm going to be the next Ron or Maharshi or something like that. No. No. There's no indication of any of that. I'm going to be abiding in the vision of uncontestability. I don't go around trying to give an indication of that because that's just attracting unnecessary attention. It's not helpful. So we may just have to pretend and lay low for a while longer here as possible. But I doubt it'll be too much longer. Again, July 24th is the date that the Holy Spirit has pointed out to me. July 24th, 2:16. July 24th, 2:16. What's going to happen? Is there going to be a yoga girl coup at that time? I don't know. Possible. Something's likely to happen. To tilt things in the wrong direction. Holy Spirit says, you better be ready by that time. Really, 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 really ready. We better be ready by a month before that, actually. June 24th. You know, what is going to happen? I don't know. But is it just some subtle spiritual tilt, you know, of emphasis in the world? Could be. Could be something more dramatic than that. But really, I have a date that I'm very much aware of. July 24th to 16. And I believe this is a very important date in the Jewish calendar too, which is the day where all the terrible things have happened in Jewish history, something like that. Yeah, it is. And I didn't know that. I got this date before. I knew that. And then the Holy Spirit said, check on the Jewish calendar. I did, and boom, there it was. Was it Tisha B'Av or something? I don't know exactly what it's called, but it's, you know, when all the disasters in Jewish history happen, it seemed to happen on this date, and then this is a date leading up to the days of mourning and something, you know, stuff like this. But wow, yeah, July 24th, look it up. It is a very, very significant date. And I've got the heads up that this something really terrible is going to happen on this date. And historically, this is the date the Jews have commemorated of, you know, destruction of this, or the temple, the walls fall, you know, the invaders come in, the heathen, the barbarian come in, and et cetera, et cetera. So, this is the date, July 24th, 2:16. Coming up fast. And, you know, Yoga Girl Coup is a pretty famous way of putting it, but that's a possibility, isn't it? There are ways that could happen, unfortunately. And I'm not going to comment on it, but nothing would be surprising that date is a date of disaster, really. For spiritual focus, for spiritual culture, this is a date of disaster. This is the Holy Spirit says, be ready. So we are getting ready. We're ready. I mean, this breakthrough right here is just fabulous. The context that we have now is just fabulous context. We have very rich context right now, gold mine of context. So whether we have this vision of uncontestability right now, or whether it doesn't happen for another month, two, or whenever it happens, we still have this context. We understand our game. We understand what's going on. We really do. It's like whether I play golf today or next week or a month from now, whatever, I understand the swing. I've got this simple, powerful, repeatable swing. I understand it. So whenever I play golf, I know it's going to be great. So whenever I abide in the vision of uncontestability, vision of sameness, it's going to be great. Whenever that comes about, and it'll come about soon enough, for sure. I realize that for sure it'll come about soon enough. But, you know, when, I don't know. But we'll try and make it today, for sure, absolutely. Always hold out hope that today's the day. Hold out hope that today's the day. Gosh, this video is really going along great. Can I handle the cold is the question. What a ferocious day today is. Listen to that wind. What a great choice I made to not play golf today. It's going to put too many doubts in my mind. It would have put too many doubts in my mind and frustrated me. I don't want that right now. I want a very positive feeling, like when I play, I'm going to play really, it's going to be really enjoyable. This is how I feel. I'm not saying I play good or bad. It's going to be very enjoyable because I'm going to be really fit. But today, this is the kind of day that can knock your confidence out of you. And the world may be in a situation that it's such a dark period, it may knock the confidence out of us, you know, if we try to really be strong, to really come on strong here, it may knock the confidence out of us. That's possible. But there's potential trouble in this world that is just off the charts. I'm telling you this. I don't want to enumerate it, actually, so we get thinking about it. But there could be, very easily, could be some stuff happen that just absolutely throw the world into turmoil. Really. I mean, there's stuff that could happen that could bring about civil war, that could bring about world war. There's stuff that there could be, you know, natural catastrophes happen. There's all sorts of stuff that easily could happen. It's all, unfortunately, set up that way. Ego set it up that way, right? It's really put us into the situation where, you know, vicious contestment could happen. And everybody could get pulled into this mood of contestment, which they already are. And most people right now are ferocious. They're ready to enter into some severe contest. Isn't that the consciousness of this world? Yes, it is. Even among those we know well, right? Close to us, there's this mood of I am like a pit bull. I'm ready to bite and hold on come what may. Very much a pit bull mentality in the world. And you know, pit bulls, once they bite, the jaws lock. You can't pry them open. You know, the dog dies, the jaws stay locked. Maybe a little pepper spray up the nose might do it. Yeah. I think that might get a little, you know, Moruga scorpion ghost pepper spray and just fill their noses with that, and they might let go. I don't know. And their eyes too, you know. Yeah. So, but the world has a pit bull mentality right now, where people are ready to bite and hold on, come what may. They really are. This is very true. This is a good way to look at it. There's a pit bull mentality among both sides, so that's why the severe contest can happen, right? This is how, while severe contests happen, is you foster a pit bull mentality among two sides, and the ego has done just this. It has done exactly this, which is why I warn everybody to stay out of this divisiveness and contestment. Don't take sides. I've been preaching this, thousands of videos, preaching this. Do not get into this pit bull mentality of contestment, because that's how severe contestments happen, is both sides get a hold of one another and bite each other, and they just hold on, and there's just this furious turmoil. Jesus says forgiveness, love your enemy, bless your adversary. Yeah, this, don't be a, have this pit bull mentality. This is best for culture, absolutely. Forgiveness is what Jesus preaches. It's necessary to keep from getting caught up in this madness. And it's also true, based on truth. But be that as it may, there's no question in my assessment of what's going on right now is people are really ready to pounce and to bite. There's a very bitey mood in the world, isn't it? I don't watch the news at all, but just asking questions of people, what their attitude is, and they're ready to bite. And when they bite, they're not, their attitude is not one that's of forgiveness or letting go. There's no let-go-ness. It's all in-ness, all go-ness, because we're going to hold on, come what may, to our position. We're going to bite and then tighten down and lock our jaws, and that's it. And then see what comes of it. Of course, this then leads to severe problems in the world. And then they'll find, you know, and they'll see what comes of it. There'll be a severe dogfight, and then at the end of it, they'll say, okay, let's now assess what happened. But this is the attitude. This is what the ego orchestrates for us here. That's what we're really orchestrating for ourselves. Just we believe that there's some external power orchestrating, we call the ego. It's not really the ego is not external to us at all. Not in the slightest bit. It's just a dance of continuity fear, really. And advising us, you know, how to keep dancing this dance and how to keep delaying. How to keep contesting. How to win. How to help out God. How to, you know, defeat the enemy, this stuff. God doesn't have any enemy. There's nothing contesting against God. It's all our own dream. How are we doing here? We're 2:30. We're blasting through 2:36. Holy cow. This is amazing. I was kind of hoping that it wouldn't do it this time because I'm freezing out here, but it is doing it. So, wow. We'll see what happens. Maybe it'll just say, okay, video over. But as long as there's, you know, this keeps going, I've got to keep talking, don't I? Reinforcing. It's a great opportunity to keep reinforcing truth here. Are there any pockets of this jacket? Let me see. Yeah, there are. Maybe that'll help if I can find some pockets here. Try to stay warm that way. We're not used to this here. We're not used to having to stay warm. It's like in this world, you know, the chill that's coming, which is just this attitude. My gosh, it didn't used to be this way. We didn't have this pit bull attitude. No, I mean, you could disagree with people and not feel scared about it. Really, can you believe that? You could state an opposing opinion, opposing viewpoint, and not feel scared or intimidated or not feel guilty or not think that you're threatening somebody or they're threatening you. Could you believe that? It's impossible now. Basically, almost virtually impossible. Don't know what to say anymore. I can't have any conversation about the topics, social things, because everybody's so polarized. I mean, if you don't agree with them, they're ready to, like, bite your neck. Or you feel guilty, they feel like you've crushed them, like you said something horrible to them. No, it didn't used to be that way. People didn't take it that seriously. So you had opinion, they'd be, what the heck, you know. It's not that important anyway. I'm not really set, and, you know, I'm not going to bite you. You're not going to bite me. I don't feel bitten, and it's all good. They'll listen to you and say, yeah, that's interesting. I haven't thought of it that way. And what about this? Oh, I think of it this way. What's your response to that? I said, well, this. And they'll listen to you and say, I hadn't really thought about it. I haven't really looked at it in that direction. That's interesting. I mean, it could be helpful. You know, people are way more that way than they are now. That's like vanished from the landscape. It's like a blizzard has descended upon the world. We're all frozen into positions in this way. Now, ascension again is very doable, very possible. It could happen. It's likely. It might happen. It's very likely that it could happen. Again, the Christians believe it will happen for sure. Many Christians do. They call it the rapture. You know, the way they symbolize it is a little cheesy, it's a little kitschy, right? Don't be discouraged by that. If it happens, Spirit will make it happen. That's all. Yeah, just go to reduced intensity zone. That's it. But just the ability to be able to converse with people, I mean, that's gone. I mean, this is a tragedy here. Because you're all on guard and all censoring what you say. And this is hideous. Hideous culture. Pit bull culture. Wow. Just like this day. It is a horrible day. I looked at the weather and said, no. It's only three mile per hour. You know, they didn't show how windy it would be. The wind chill factor and any of that stuff. I mean, come on, weather people, you can do way better than this. I mean, what do we want to know? What do we really want to know? What's the real temperature going to be like? The actual, you know, computing the wind chill and the moisture content and all that stuff. Give us a, you know, it's going to feel like what? What is it going to feel like? The thermometer may say 52, but it feels like 45 or something, right? Or worse. Just give us what it's going to feel like so we can plan our day accordingly. So in this world, what's it going to feel like coming up after July 24th? What's this world going to feel like? That's what's important. We need to be like, you know, social weather people. What is it going to feel like? What's the mood of the world? Is it going to be a pit bull world at that point? Led by the yoga girls, saying, everybody, you know, here we are, we're the leaders of the New World Order. We're going to lead you into success, to winning. We know how to win. You're going to be happy. And everybody has to do this, otherwise we feel that you're trying to attack us. So is it going to be polarized? You know, how severe? What's it going to feel like? What's our culture going to feel like? This is the forecast we need to have. And we need an accurate forecast so we can plan accordingly, right? So I'm trying to give an accurate forecast of it here. My forecast is severe trouble. Very severe trouble. Very stormy. It's going to feel very stormy, let's put it that way. It's going to feel very, it's a not good golf weather, so to speak. They use golf as a metaphor. It's going to be very cold and stormy is my forecast. Doing this advanced forecast. It's all trending in that direction. It's all trending in that direction. Whew. Yeah, it's a long one here. What can I do? I gotta generate tummo or body heat, you know, some kind of spiritual heat here, like the Tibetans do or up there. Wrap themselves in ice water, dip all their clothes in ice water, and then wrap it around themselves and sit there, and it's, you know, sub-zero, incredibly cold, and they just generate this body, this heat that keeps them feel nice and warm. That's a good ability to have there, isn't it? Very useful. Like people in the tropics say, well, what? Why should we work on that? That's not helpful for us. We want to generate body coolness. How do you do that? Generate body coolness. Well, in the Bible, they say what Daniel in the lion's den or something, or the heat, some furnace or fire that the Christians are applied to, or prophets or something, and they're able to stay cool in this fire. Fire didn't touch them. A lot of Christians have been put them to the stake, try to burn them in fire, just keeps them cool. Really, a lot of different ways of trying to be used to kill Christians throughout history, and a lot of times they didn't work at all. So they had to try to use other ways, other means. Or they just let them go, say, to heck with it. We don't want to get in trouble with God here. Let's just let this one go. So they were able to generate coolness, like that flames wouldn't even touch them. That'd be a more useful help in a desert, kind of hot environment, right? Whereas Tibet, it'd be more useful to generate heat, that coldness doesn't touch them. And really is the attitude, no contestment. If you have this attitude, there's no contestment, then your body's going to be fine. It's going to feel perfect. However that appears in this world doesn't really matter. What's the global spiritual weather forecast for July 24th to 16th? Not good at all. So we make plans accordingly, that sort of thing. Let's say, for example, let's say you want to play golf on that date, just use an analogy. And the weather forecast, it's cold, stormy, you get terrible golf weather. You say, okay, well, maybe I want to take a golf vacation. Let's go down to the desert, and it's going to be nice and warm there, and be able to play golf there. So we make plans accordingly, according to the weather forecast. Well, we know the spiritual weather forecast is very bad here. We might say, let's go to another place where we can hang out and enjoy our spiritual freedom and bliss and peace. Where we not feel like we're being pressured into contestment, because the mood is so strong towards contestment, we might really feel pressured to get back into that, to abandon our the abandoned truth. We don't want to do that. So we're told that in the end times, the pressure in this world will be so severe that even the saints will be in danger of backsliding into self-delusion. So we might prepare to say, I'll take a little vacation. Let's take a little vacation from this. Let's commission a vacation. Let's commission retirement for ourselves. At the very least, commission a vacation for ourselves, right? A spiritual vacation. And again, if we do that, Spirit can take care of doing it. It's not a problem. The intellect doesn't have to know how to do it. Spirit will do it. If we decide that's what we want to commission, that's what will happen. Jesus tells us, you'll know the way. When it's time for that, you'll know where and the way, and you'll know everything. It's not a problem for you. The reason why I'm getting more time is because the background is white and the foreground is black, and there's not a bunch of shades in between, so it uses less computational space to produce this, this video. It's very black and white. Easy to see the contrast. There's very little grayscale to this image, right? So it's gone 2 hours and 49 minutes already, and it's only used 3.19 gigabytes. Usually, 4 gigabytes is used by about like 227, 17, something like that. That's it. So it's a great analogy showing that seeing it cut and dried, black and white, easy to distinguish between truth and lies. This is the kind of realm we want to hang out in. Easy, a reduced intensity zone, easy to distinguish truth and lies. This is what really protects us from the storminess that that's likely to come in this world. When you get pit bull attitudes in a world, and when you cultivate those, which we have done, which media and entertainment has done, and our socialization, our education, our, all of this, the politics, everything has cultivated a pit bull attitude. You are courting trouble. At the very least, you're courting severe trouble. It's like going out in the ocean and chumming with all this blood in the water. You're courting trouble from sharks, aren't you? Absolutely you are. So it's like if you're out in the swimming in the ocean and you're spreading all this blood in the water around you as much as possible, and you're in the environment where great white sharks are, where there's many, you are simply asking for trouble. Guaranteed you're asking for trouble. Now, will you have the trouble or not? Well, there's a high likelihood you will. Sharks got pretty good noses, right? So, we are in this world, we are courting trouble, very severely courting trouble, by developing this pit bull attitudes in our minds, in our consciousness. Will the trouble come? It's a very strong likelihood it will. It's not, you can't say, I can't say it's 100% for sure, but when you ask for trouble and you court trouble, you're very likely to get it. Very likely to get it. So this is an, I would say, accurate assessment of this world. And we keep forestalling it, but what are we doing in the meantime? Developing more and more pit bull attitude. Because we want to win. Say, well, I'm not quite ready to win yet. But when we think, those in the world think that they can win, that's when they're likely to bite and then just hold on, come what may. They think at the end they'll be the last one standing, so to speak. They'll be the winner. Winner. And therefore, they say, well, we'll be happy. We'll be happy. We helped God win. The idea that God's on the side of someone is ridiculous. God is this perfectly spaced out smoothness of pure spaciousness that allows all everything to arise. All ornamentation and non-ornamentation to arise equally. No such thing as God being on the side of some contest at all. There's no contest taking place. God is not aware of any contest taking place. You could say the grace of God certainly favors a non-contesting culture in order to recognize that there's nothing is being, God cannot be contested. You could say that, but how that works out is not, it's not forced. It's not an issue that's forced. I cannot really speak exactly on that. But it could very well work out as far as ascension. Off this, you know, ascension to a higher realm, or to a reduced intensity zone, I call it, in Arizona, it could work out that way. Wouldn't be surprising at all if it worked out that way, for those who want that, to sidestep this trouble. I've already seen myself sidestepping the trouble in the world to come, the conflict to come. I've had dreams that show what's to come, very severe conflict. Very severe contestment, and I was able to sidestep it, found a way. So we're working on this just in case. If it doesn't happen, then we'll witness here to non-dual abidance for sure. I will certainly do that. But if the contestment is too severe here, that the storm is too severe, then maybe we need to sidestep it, go to a reduced intensity zone. Absolutely. So we'll have that option. Well, we should have that option ready, willing to have that option. If it comes to that, hopefully it doesn't come to that here. We don't wish that upon this world. We don't want turmoil here, conflict at all. Because that interferes with our witnessing to the uncontestable vision of uncontestability. Of course, those who want to win don't want to have the vision of uncontestability. They feel that it helps, means it lets their enemy off the hook. They want to defeat the enemy. The enemy these days is hurting them, is causing them problems. So they don't want to see that. They want to see that, yeah, there is a contest, but we see a way to win it. That's what they're interested in. That's what I found in this world. You try to teach truth, and people say, well, how does that help me beat my opponent? How does it help me defeat my terrible enemy that I have? That's what they're interested in. This is delusion. This freedom comes from recognizing truth is uncontestable. Reality is uncontestable. Truly it is. And anything other than that is just illusion and our own dream, our own arrogance, actually. That's all that it is. Wow, this one may set an all-time record for length. This is like the worst golf weather probably in a long time. And I was thinking about going out and play golf today. I tried to force it. Wow. Holy Spirit jumped in and said no. You see how the Holy Spirit helps? Jumped in and said no, it's too crowded. And that kind of got me like, oh, I don't like being crowded. What do you mean it's too crowded? I hate that. It's too crowded, too crowded, too crowded. Okay, I finally relented and said, okay. All right, you're the boss. You know what's what. You know what's to come. The Holy Spirit knows the weather, knows everything. It's demonstrated that to me many times. Today was a perfect example. It basically said, no, you're going to hate it. You're going to hate it. It's going to be lousy. Don't do it. It's too much trouble for you. And I said, I can handle anything. Don't worry. No. He says, too much. I said, oh, wow, okay. So I relented. I said, it's a good sign. It's like the Holy Spirit, I remember, told me, don't watch television anymore back in the 90s, late 90s, I think. I said, I can handle it. He said, no, it's too much trouble. Too much trouble. It'll be too much trouble for you. And so I relented. Same thing at various times in my life. The Holy Spirit said, this is going to be too much trouble for you. Don't do it. And I relented and said, okay, you're the boss. And it turned out to be right. The Holy Spirit knows what is to come. It turned out to be right. And it turned out to be right again today. Absolutely it did. Wow. Brutal. Brutal, brutal. You go out and try to play golf in this way at the end of 18 holes, you're going to just feel like you've been brutalized. You could be numb. You're going to just say, God, I'm not going to do that ever again. Wow, this is horrible. That wasn't fun at all. So the Holy Spirit does know what's going to come in this world. It does know. It absolutely knows. Right now. So, it's just preparing us. It's not necessarily saying exactly what's going to come. I already had dreams that show it pretty clearly, but you know, it doesn't want to spook us too much. It just says, prepare. Get the context clear. Keep clarifying the context here. And why we're having trouble. It's not because this information is incorrect. It's because the culture is so unwelcoming to it. It's making it very difficult. And it's welcoming to false teaching. Very welcoming to false non-dual teaching. To mistaken teaching. It's very welcoming to that. And so that's dangerous. The Holy Spirit said that's a great danger right now. There's so much false teaching in this world. It's easy as you try to teach truly that you'll compromise and go and say, well, okay, if I say this, then many people pay attention. But if I don't say this, nobody will pay attention. It's very tempting then to become a false teacher here. It's very tempting. And that's a disaster. You're going to have trouble if you do that. It's better to not teach at all than to be a false teacher. It really is. False teachers, they end up suicidal, actually. They do. They just feel trapped and they feel, wow, what can I do? This is horrible. And they end up suicidal, false teachers who. So it's better, if you can't teach truly, it's better to not teach at all. Just go play golf. Yeah, Lao Tzu. Remember Lao Tzu? He left China. He says, "This culture won't allow me to teach here. It's better I not teach at all than try to teach here, because I'll get pulled into false teaching and subtle, clever. You know, the yoga girls are ready to pounce here and say, 'Well, we'll support this. If this is what you want to teach, if you want to teach this, then we'll be very supportive. We'll actually put you up to be like the chief teacher of the world, as long as you teach this particular doctrine this way.' That sure, winning is possible. Of course it is, because we're the cheerleaders. You yoga girls are the cheerleaders of winning. This is the problem. They're getting all ready to be very cheerleadery. I mean, so I remember growing up, so many people just hated the cheerleaders. They were so hated. It's funny, I talked to a woman who, you know, went through all that, and I didn't know. She said, "Oh, we hated the cheerleaders. All the women hated them." I didn't know that, the girls at that time. You know, they just like, those just had a very great resentment of cheerleaders. The guys didn't like them either, you know, because they kind of ruled things. Cheerleaders really ruled the roost. They really did. In high school, they really ruled the roost. They set the social gospel of the high school. Because, of course, all the big athletes, you know, the cheerleaders dated all them, of course. You know, even the young freshman cheerleaders would date like seniors, you know. And of course, they controlled the men, and the men said, "Look, this is how we want things to be." Then that's how the big jock athletes, that's how they would, you know, they'd say, "Okay, this is how it's got to be." So cheerleaders really had the most power of anyone in high school, for sure. And that cheerleader mentality continues through college, and now it's through, you know, the yoga girls are like the spiritual cheerleaders. They're like spiritual cheerleaders. This is a great way to look at it. The yoga girls are spiritual cheerleaders. And so there isn't going to be any spirituality in this world, really, that the yoga girls don't want. Just like the jocks on a football team, you know, they got to be with part of the in crowd, or you don't play. The other jocks will say, "Hey, we don't want you on our team." Because why? Well, the cheerleaders don't like you. Our girlfriends don't like you. So you can't be part of the in crowd at all. This is how it works. This is the pressure that's brought to bear in this world. So yeah, the yoga girls are like spiritual cheerleaders. They have the power. They'll say, "Well, okay, who's our opponent? This is our opponent." They'll say, "This is our opponent. This is what I want you to do. This is how I want you to win. I want you to beat the opponent severely and forever and ever. And let's make the defeat decisive. And the light will have defeated the darkness decisively, because we cheerleaded you into doing your best effort." And of course, cheerleaders' idea is that they get the jocks to play to their utmost, to be reckless abandon, to fight to the end, to be great warriors. That's what they're out cheerleading, saying, look how attractive we are. Look, we're urging you on to greater and greater efforts. And because we're mad with desire towards you, because we're seeing how your valor and heroism is so incredible, we're just jumping up and down and screaming and squealing with delight, and flinging ourselves almost in wild abandon here. Wow, we're so completely fired up by your valor on the football field. It's driving us insane with mad desire. And so they cheerleading, that's what they do. They jump around screaming, "Wow, go, isn't this amazing? We're so excited by this display of awesome brute strength and valor and warriorness." Well, the yoga cheerleaders do that spiritually. We're so fired up by you preaching how we got to defeat the enemy, and finally got the enemy in our sights, and now we're going to decisively defeat the enemy. We're going to get rid of darkness. We're going to spread the gospel of love and forgiveness and kindness, and after defeating our enemy, we will, you know, well, this is all totally delusional and dualistic, completely. You don't see Ramana Maharshi doing that, do you? Is he chasing down the bad guys? No. He's just looking at us in absolute silence with just this blissful reassurance. Silence is also conversation. You got Sri Sri Nanda Maimasa. Everything's already perfect. What are you talking about? I need to defeat the bad guys. Everything's perfect. Everything's God. It's always God. I don't need to do anything. You have Jesus saying, there's nothing you need to do. To say there's absolutely nothing I need to do. All is already perfect. Just forgive your the notion that you ever had to do anything. Forgive yourself for believing there ever could God perfection could ever be contested. Forgive yourself for that. That's all you need. Just forgive yourself. That's it. I don't have to forgive anybody else. Nobody's ever done anything to me. There can never be any contestment. That's just all illusion. That's real teaching. You don't see the cheerleaders cheerleading for that, do you? No, they're saying, let's spin this in a different direction. So again, the Holy Spirit's pointed out to me, these yoga girls are too much trouble. Believe me. The Holy Spirit says, believe me. This, you don't want any part of that. You don't want to be their champion, that is for sure. Discretion is the better part of valor, for sure. Just like not playing golf today was the better part of valor. Discretion is the best part of valor. This is, wow. Crazy wind, crazy. Wow, it is really stormy now. Discretion is the better part of valor, including spiritual valor. This is what the Holy Spirit has pointed out to me. Discretion is the better part of spiritual valor also. We don't want to lose our confidence. Your confidence is very important in spiritual teaching. You have to maintain abidance. If you lose abidance, then you're going the wheels will come off. You know, especially if you're in a position of authority. Basically, then you have to say, look, I lost it. You know, so I have to resign. You know, there's some are forced into that just by lawsuits and so much pressure. I mean, rarely do you get anyone spiritually who will admit that, you know, they lost the abidance. They've slipped out of it because everybody's expecting them. No, we need you to lead us to the promised land of victory, spiritual victory. I mean, there's been a teacher recently that kind of resigned. But most people say that he did so only under, you know, severe pressure. And it was just an expedient thing to do. And it wasn't really genuine or wholehearted or anything like that. And maybe they have a point about that. And maybe that is, you know, as... But rarely do you get gurus resigning and saying, I lost the abidance. It can happen. But generally the followers insist that, because they're out for victory, right? They're out for victory. And they're the ones who look for this kind of teacher in the first place, who would put on a good show, but actually is not in genuine abidance, or would easy, they could think they could force them to lose it, and then they can control the teacher, the yoga girls can control the teacher, and get them to gain the kind of victory they think is necessary for their happiness. This has happened over and over and over and over again throughout history. It's happening now, it's happened in recent history. This is very common. But Ramana Maharshi is a great example of someone who could not be dragged out of abidance. And Ananda Mayama is another example of someone who could not be dragged out of abidance. They tried their best to, that is for sure. The yoga girls really did try. But didn't work. And so they said, That's failure on our part. Failure. We don't need to pay any more attention to her. It's not many are focusing on Sri Sri Anandamayi at this point. It's because they couldn't drag her off of Biden's. They think, well, what good is that? We thought she had potential, but didn't really happen. Potential. Potential to what? To be a savior. To win a battle, you know, win the contest, the non-existent contest. She said, there's no contest. What are you talking about? She said, no. There's a big contest, but you can help us win it, and we'll all follow you if you just, you know, recognize what needs to be defeated. She says, nothing needs to be defeated. Everything's perfect. What are you talking about? Everything's God. Everything's pure spaciousness. There's no contest. And they said, what a pity. You could, so much potential. You could have helped us, but you refused to do so. Something wrong with you. I don't know what it was. This is the attitude. It's a million times worse now than back then. Discretion is the better part of valor. So Holy Spirit said, don't go today. No. And I was all fired up to do it. I said, I feel great. I feel limber and strong. I can do it. The Holy Spirit said, no. And so I had this big struggle this morning over this. And I relented. Discretion's a better part of valor. Turned out to be right. Turned out to be the very smart thing to do, to not try and play golf. Because I'm turned into an ice cube. Turned into ice cube here, but at least got this video out. And it's been, you know, supremely helpful to those who... But to everyone, really, because it's in everyone's consciousness. Everything we do is known to the one mind. It's ticking away. This video is really cooking away. I restarted the computer so I'd get a clean run here and nothing would interfere, and it's turned out to be a great idea. That's another thing that I did right. I was trying to get this, to take this video without restarting the computer, and everything was going slow. I said, I have a feeling I could have a problem. So I restarted it. It delayed things a little bit. It did delay things a little bit. But with the restart, reboot, there's been no problems whatsoever. This is recorded beautifully. So that's another analogy for the world. And maybe we need to delay a little bit before we really start a real strong teaching mission. But I guarantee you that when circumstances are right, so there will be an embracing of teaching, the right teaching, and be ready. People say, yeah, I really want to do this. I'll be ready at that point to teach for sure. And many, many will. We'll have a great, 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 you know, revival of true teaching. But it just may be that this time coming up in the short term may be just too stormy for that. This is what the Bible tells us. This is what Jesus told us in the Bible. He hasn't said anything about it in A Course in Miracles, that's for sure, or recently, but he certainly stressed urgency to me. There's a very urgent situation, but hasn't been specific at all about it. Probably not to interfere, to get too much of our attention on that, but rather it's more important to spiritually prepare successfully, which is what I've tried to urge people to do. Tried to get away from being overly specific without denying that there could be some very stormy situation coming up. Wow, it's going to be very nice to get out of this cold into the warm house when this video is over, and I'm seeing it through to the bitter end here. Yeah, I'm looking forward to that. Maybe eating something besides the tart red cherry juice with chocolate protein powder, which was not very tasty. It was different, I'll tell you that. I've never tasted anything quite like that. Wow. But just the fact I'm in such great shape means I can do this like a 3.5 hour video, like in the freezing cold out here, and I'm able to do it. It's a testimony to, you know, the kind of condition I'm in. Which is, you know, comes about through dedication. But hey, when I was faced with that situation with that girl who looked, couldn't hardly figure out if it was a guy or a girl, but she was so messed up, I just chose discretion. Better part of valor there. It was a gut feeling. I said, I don't need to prove anything really. This is just too much trouble. I got a feeling that, and son of a gun, if the police didn't show up out of nowhere, I guess they've been trailing her actually. They've been tipped off. And they're just waiting for the right area to encounter her, to say, hey. And so they were aware of her apparently and were trailing her. I didn't know that. And then they pounced on her, you know, two policemen. Well, you might say duality. She attracted duality, didn't she? Two dark policemen, and policemen in dark black uniforms. And then things got very intense there, and they made it clear that I wasn't to interfere. So you might say that she attracted the attitude of heavy duality, very heavy situation there. I just at a distance, I just looked at, see what was going on at a distance, and they kind of looked at me, who's he, I just looked at, I'm just, you know, just an onlooker, no worries, so they weren't disturbed by me. They didn't feel I was any problem or threat or anything. So she attracted duality, didn't she? Yes, she did. A duality magnet. Heavy, heavy law enforcement issue. So if I had tried to go help her, I would have been in that situation. I would have gotten entangled with the police too, in terms of who are you, what are you trying to do, you know? And I tried maybe try to defend myself, and you know that would have been a you know bad scene. So I did the right thing. Discretion is a better part of valor. And I thought, well, maybe she looks like a man, but she's really a woman. I'm not sure what she is. Maybe I can talk with her. Maybe she's someone who's open-minded. No. She's cuckoo, and she was deranged. So just the fact that these, you know, the yoga girls are maybe trying to be more like men. A lot of women are trying to be like men actually now. That doesn't mean that they're more open to listening to a man, you know, witness to them, truth to them. No. It may be they feel that they can be very intensely aggressive and pit bullish. Actually, like I said, I saw this woman walking down the street downtown. My God, the pit bull attitude in them was just intense. I said, man, I don't want to get bit by them, but they're not going to let go. And this is very strong. You're seeing so many women, they have a very strong pit bull mentality. These yoga girls really are encouraging that. Says, look, we got an opportunity to win, decisively win, finally. We want a decisive victory now over whatever it is that we feel we need to contest against. And we can be champions of God and show God that we're on God's side because we're ready to fight a battle for God. This is, you know, total delusion, self-delusion, arrogance. The idea that God can be contested is sheer arrogance on our part. Now we're getting up close to the 4 gigabyte mark, which is nice. That means probably the end is in sight. So discretion is the better part of spiritual valor. Keep this in mind. Don't be spiritually arrogant and thinking I can go out and convert these yoga girls, no problem. No. It doesn't work that way. Besides, the law has been rigged here in this world to support conflict. It really has been rigged. And people realize this. I've talked to numerous people who say, hey, the law is complete. I've talked to people who are not hardly even educated. I've talked to people, you'd be amazed. I had a recent conversation with somebody. He said, hey, the laws are all crazy. They're all in support of this insanity that's going on. There's nothing you can do. It's crazy. And this is just people who are not don't have an education. No, it's common sense. It's spiritually, you can see it for yourself. It's just, you just see it, notice it. Oh, wait a minute, you know. Can't control the kids, can't do this, can't do that, can't do that. This is nuts. This culture is nuts. People coming from different cultures in the United States, they say this culture is insane. They don't need to be brilliant to see that. It's self-evident, actually. Spiritually, you see it spiritually. If you haven't been all messed up spiritually on drugs or whatever, it's easy to see. Very easy to see. So again, you have people coming from other cultures, other lands. They may not be some big shots at all, but they just say, hey, this is what I'm seeing. And I say, wow, that's very wise what you're seeing. And this is what I see too. We're just so messed up in this culture here that it's hard for us to see what's obvious. And again, I have people tell me that they are aware that most of the people, young people in like high school, are smoking pot. Almost everyone. And I say, "Are you sure? Really? It's crazy. Are you what? I can hardly believe it." And I said, "Well, look, I bet you know some Asian girls are not, because they're studying like crazy to be doctors or something." So, but you know, but they said, "No, by and large, most people are at least trying it early, or and a lot of them are smoking pot recreationally. It's just very acceptable now. Totally acceptable. It's not even, you know, the idea that it's bad or something is not even something in their consciousness. They think you're crazy if you say that. Take great offense at that." And I says, "Holy cow. That really knocks out spiritual awareness very severely. It makes you very naive and vulnerable to being, you know, pulled into conflict and not even see it coming. Makes you real stupid, actually. It gives you a false impression of intelligent, smart, spiritual smartness, a very false impression of it. It really does. And you get blindsided by conflict, by the pit bull culture. You get blindsided. You say, 'No, I'm mellow, man. I'm cool. I'm this.' No, you're on drugs. You're not really cool at all. You're not really spiritually cooled out at all. Easy to get pulled into conflict and depression and suicidal depression, actually, from that standpoint. It's like, oh my gosh, I don't know what to do. I didn't see it coming. What's wrong with me? What happened? Be unprepared. It makes you very unprepared. Drugs makes you very unprepared, very incapable of preparing. I mean, look at me. I could, you know, three and a half hours almost of intense witnessing here. You know, where someone else could be smoking pot and spend 3.5 hours, or just like, oh, you know, I'm really cool, I'm spiritually cool, I feel really mellow, man, you know. That's fake spirituality. You don't really understand no conflict, no contestment. You don't really understand no contestment. You can't really sidestep it, you know. You don't.